Final lap kind of summed up the whole first half of the season so far. The seven-time champion versus the young upstart. In the end, the youngster won this battle. But will he win the season-long war? Is this the year that youth overcomes experience? Here's Randy Pemberton.
Well, the youngster is starting deep in the pack today. He's sandwiched in the middle of Sterling Marlin and Dale Earnhardt in the Winston Cup point standings. Hottest guy on the circuit still, though. 33% of the laps he's led, or 35% of the miles, Jeff. But you're starting way back after winning seven poles. You're 21st today. What happened in qualifying?
Well, I was just trying to take about a fifth qualifying car to the pole. And, you know, I took it on the edge like I do every weekend and got a little bit too far over the edge, got a little loose and got the right rear into the wall. And, you know, we had to work real hard, but that just shows how tough this team is. They bounced back. We came back yesterday, had a good run. We were fastest yesterday, starting 21st here. But, you know, it's 300 laps, but that's a long time around this place. So hopefully we can get up to the front.
Okay, no doubt about it. All eyes will be on him as he marches toward the front today. Glenn Jarrett.
Well, thanks, Randy. If youth is Jeff Gordon, which it is, then experience is this man, Dale Earnhardt. And this guy has won seven crowns. I don't think that he's quite ready to give it up yet. Those young guys been running good, but you still got a lot of racing left in you.
Well, we hope we have. Feel like we got several more years anyway, Glenn. You know, it's real competitive. You know, a guy with a talent like Gordon comes in here with the good equipment, and he can win races. But still, we feel like we can win some more championships, some more races ourselves, and we're looking forward to the future. Not ready to start our own team, like you said this morning on TV on race day, but we're gonna look down the road to maybe owning one someday when I'm ready to retire 10 or so years.
Well, the report that I made on race day this morning has been emphatically and categorically denied by both Richard Childress and Dale Earnhardt. I stand corrected. I hang my head in humble apology. Is that good enough? Okay. Now, the plights of both Gordon and Earnhardt this year have only been two of the major stories in a year that's been chock full of interesting developments.
I read the news today, oh boy.
What a season of headlines so far. Controversy, dominance, parity among car makes, new faces in victory lane. Fierce battles on and off the track. But as we head into the second half of 95 with ratings and attendance records, this season's been a knockout. TNN Motorsports presents live coverage of the Slick 50 300 from the Magic Mile of Loudoun, New Hampshire. And it is jam-packed with race fans. They've been arriving here since Thursday. They sat through rain yesterday, but today the temperature is in the mid-70s and the humidity is some 30 points cooler than it was, or rather lower than it was yesterday afternoon. Welcome to the Granite State, everybody. I'm Mike Joy. This racetrack, since they began holding Winston Cup racing on this one-mile flat oval, has always favored the driver who could best adjust on his car throughout the day and take advantage of increasingly slick track conditions. Well, the top of the Winston Cup standings, that's increasingly slick as well. Three drivers are an unprecedented just 16 points apart here at the midpoint of the season, as we see in our Texaco Haviland point standings. So, what to expect from this, the midpoint race in the season? To my colleagues, Buddy Baker and Ernie Irvin. Buddy, what kind of race do you look for today?
Three wide down the front straightaway, double wide in the corners. There's a new sealer on the bottom side of the racetrack, but it does not bother the competition. Great racing all day.
Ernie, the drivers did not get a last practice session yesterday. Was there a lot of guesswork in the garage this morning?
Well, there was a lot of guesswork, but they did have a practice right before it started raining yesterday afternoon. And, you know, there was about 15 or 20 cars that could run the same speed. I think that it's going to be the most competitive race we've ever seen here at New Hampshire.
Well, it's certainly the most competitive point battle. Let's go down to the point leader and Randy Pemberton.
Well, Sterling Marlin will sit 31st on this grid today. He has two Winston Cup victories, the best average finisher of the Winston Cup season so far with an 8.33. Sterling, you're deep in the field. We've already talked about this track changing a lot during the day. Are you guys ready for that, and can you get to the front?
Well, we changed a bunch on it this morning, and a lot of cars did what in the last practice, and we're just going to go give it the best shot and see what happens. We've got some adjustments we can make and whatever we have to do, so we should be in pretty good shape, I think.
Okay, good luck, Sterling. Well, Sterling Marlin got to come from deep in the pack, but he has a lot of company back here. Dale Earnhardt and Rusty Wallace starting just inside the top 20. Well, we'll be back with live coverage from the Slick 55 300 right after this.
Trade that in for a real one. Okay. Hello, Billy. I'm fine. I can hear.
Hello, how are you? Hi, Pam. Did not get out of that chassis
Hello.
Set up easy.
Numbers up here.
It's yours.
Point standings up there.
Not that it makes any.
Spotter cam.
Thank
What's
you.
Spotter cam?
We Red Dog's got a camera on his hat.
Oh, okay. Red Dog.
Red Dog.
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? By Cold Filtered Miller Genuine Draft, making the world a very cool place. By Texaco, clean System 3 gasolines. Add more life to your car. Take it to the star. And by the more than 1,000 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts.
You see a heavy cloud cover over New Hampshire International Speedway. It'll keep it cool on these thousands of fans. 22 acres of new parking Bob Baer added for this weekend. It is all full, and these grandstands are all packed. Here's the AutoZone race analysis brought to you by the more than 1,000 AutoZone stores across America. 41 cars in today's field for the 317-mile distance. Rusty Wallace is the race record holder, set 2 years ago. Pit strategy as they roll off the starting grid. Here's Glenn.
Well, Mike, the cars are just now rolling away, and the strategy so far, everybody, as you guys said earlier on, was a little bit concerned about what to do to their cars. Everybody, that is, except Martin Martin, they were fast right from the get-go, made very few changes on the cars. We can look for about 85 to 100 laps on fuel, and they also say that the tires will last that long too. So really, the fuel stop and the tire window should be about the same today. Depends on how the things shake out. It'll be a little skitterish starting out. The cars will skate a little bit because of the soft rubber that was left down from the modified in the Busch North race yesterday, which finished up last night. So look for the guys to sort things out a little bit early on. But nobody really made a lot of major chassis adjustments or changes that I talked to. By the way, this is the same tire that the Busch cars ran last week at Milwaukee, similar type racing surface. So I really look for Dale Jarrett to have a good day. They've got the same type setup under their car. A lot of good guys on flat tracks here today. This is going to be a heck of a show, Mike.
Thanks, Glenn. Let's have a look at the starting lineup. Mark Martin, new track record. His Valvoline Ford is on the pole. Robert Presley in the Skoll Chevrolet, his best qualifying effort outside row one. Row number two, Joe Nemechek, also has his best start of the season. And Bill Elliott has his first top five start of the year. Bobby Labonte, the winner at Charlotte and Michigan in row three. And Rick Mass, second top 10 start for Rick this year. Ricky Rudd is the defending champion of this race, and Kyle Petty, who won at Dover last month, that's row four. Michael Waltrip, eighth of the points, and Ken Schrader in row five. Row six, Morgan Shepherd, sixth here last year, and Dick Trickle had a strong run in Daytona last week. Row seven, Terry Labonte, the winner in Richmond and Pocono, and Dale Jarrett. Row number eight, Jeremy Mayfield, and Hutch Strickland, who has three top tens in the last five races since joining Kenny Bernstein's team. Ted Musgrave, fourth in the point standings, and last year's runner-up here, Dale Earnhardt. Ricky Craven won yesterday's Busch North race, and Rusty Wallace, who won the first Slick 50 300 here. Jeff Gordon, fastest second-round qualifier, and Jeff Bodine. Derek Cope for his first win since 1990, and Dave Marcus starts his 776th Winston Cup race today. Elton Sawyer in the Junior Johnson Ford, and Bobby Hamilton has five top tens this year. Ward Burton and Todd Bodine, who was fifth here last season. John Andretti and Jeff Burton, who made his Cup debut 2 years ago here. Sterling Marlin, the point leader, is deep in the field, and Darrell Waltrip. Rich Bickle with the Dick Brooks Felix Sabates team, and Steve Grissom, who had a fifth at Wilkesboro this year. Mike Wallace makes his second New Hampshire start. Blake Speed, who was eighth in Charlotte. Bobby Hillen Jr. and Jimmy Hensley makes his second start for Bill Davis. Brett Bodine, qualifying troubles. We'll clue you in on that later on. And Jimmy Spencer looks for his first win since almost a year ago. And Chuck Bound, twice a runner-up here in Busch Series competition. Chevrolet Corvette pace car leads them around. And they have been running a lap at the pit road speed since they didn't get to do so yesterday afternoon.
In the middle of one and two, they say the lead is.
Riding with Sterling Marlin and telling him about a piece of debris out on the racetrack in turn number two. You saw the track truck there to go pick it up. There's the roof cam.
I don't see it.
McClure Kodak Chevrolet. And out the rear window, Sterling Marlin's car. And out the right side window as well, looking across at Darrell Waltrip. We'll be on the pole with Mark Martin in the Valvoline Cummins diesel Ford of Jack Roush, both inside and up top on the roof cam and out the right side window of Mark's car as well. And Dave Marcus, the Olive Garden Prodigy Computer Service Chevrolet, starting 24th today. Dave told me this morning he will not have Ward Burton in his car next year, as Glenn was also emphatically told. He intends to drive it himself next season once again. So we'll give you a ride, and we'll also be able to talk to Dave Marcus today, thanks to our racing electronics in-car radios.
Mike, you see how fast they're running under the caution here. What they're doing is seating in the brakes. They didn't have time yesterday to run the brakes in, so they're running a little bit faster than normal going down the back straightaway. You can see they're running about 100 miles an hour, seating the brakes in for the start of the race.
We'll have another new view to show you today. We'll be up on the roof to the right of our broadcast position. You are looking from the hat of Buddy Red Dog Barnes. He is the spotter from John Andretti, the Kmart Little Caesars Prentice Haas Ford, number 37, and you'll see what he is looking at as he gives instruction to John, and you'll be able to hear those instructions as John Andretti there moves around the speedway. That's Andretti's Ford, and Buddy Barnes checking things out. Don't look at those grandstands, Buddy.
Oh, that's a nice grandstand. By the way, congratulations to Ernie Irvin. He's up here with us today in the booth. He went to Bristol and helped set up his truck, and they won their first race there in Bristol with Joe Ruttman driving. And thanks to Ernie, they had a super ride there.
I tell you, you know, thanks to Joe, he really drove the wheels off that thing. And, you know, it was a lot of fun. I've been to Victory Lane before at Bristol, and this was special, too.
Well, silly season begins the second half of the season. 22 Fords, 14 Chevys, 5 Pontiacs. There will not be that sixth Pontiac in Winston Cup racing. At least it won't be out of the Ricky Rudd stable. He announced this weekend that he had talked to the folks in Pontiac, but Rudd's tied team will stay with Ford next year. That puts one rumor to rest. Gosh, there are a lot of them flying about what will happen next year to drivers, car owners, crew chiefs, lots of folks in this sport. There's Jack Roush, who owns the pole sitting car of Mark Martin and the fourth place point standing car of Ted Musgrave. Yesterday, Jack was gripped to a t-shirt and shorts inside of Mark's truck, putting together a cylinder head for Ted Musgrave's car.
But he had that hat on, I guarantee it. I think he takes a shower with that thing on.
We're going flat track in here in New Hampshire. The banking is only 12 degrees at its highest point, 1,500 foot straightaways on this 1 mile oval built from the old 1.6 mile Breyer Motorsports Park. Now plays host to Winston Cup, the Busch Series, the Featherlite Modified Tour, Indy Cars, the Loudon Classic for motorcycle, and SCCA amateur events. Go-karts, you name it. Everybody races here at the Magic Mile.
Boy, the hearts are pumping right now. Well, this is probably the most intriguing part of the race, is when you're waiting on that green flag to fly. Coming down there, every once in a while, your kneecap will jump a little bit. You really get ready for the start.
Mark Martin's Ford, Robert Presley's Chevrolet on the front row. And we are under green at New Hampshire for the Slick 5300.
Well, Mark got a nice jump to see Robert Presley though on the outside. That's a great part of this racetrack. You can race fast on the outer groove there.
Going out of turn number two. Presley has Nemechek to the inside. Joe won a Busch race here. Stole it from Dale Earnhardt on the last lap.
The fourth car in the picture there, that's Bobby Labonte. He was one of the fastest cars in morning practice yesterday. You see Nemechek's car just a little bit loose coming out of turn four.
With which the Cup race Mark Martin has led since Charlotte in May. Presley in 33.87 is Nemechek 18. Labonte, and whoa, Nemechek almost tossed the bun away with a burger there.
I think I'm going to throw that loose condition, little loose. That's a bunch loose right there.
Yeah, I tell you, it looked like the car in front of him had actually got a little bit loose and slowed down, and Nemechek was making sure he didn't hit him.
Here comes Ricky Rudd in trouble in turn three. Dave Marcus has spun around. Dale Jarrett is in the fence.
That's amazing. Wow, how many times has that happened to him this year, right at the first of a race?
Well, every TNN race. Dover, Pocono, here. Wow. He finished the Winston Select. We'll have to check.
The nice part is it does not look like a lot of damage.
And, you know, I see her happy, but you know how those deals go. I hit it for the grass, but somebody got me.
That's Dave Marcus you're listening to as we're on board the Olive Garden Chevrolet. Here's what happened.
Blake Speed is right behind him. Looked like he got into the left rear corner just a little bit. You see Dale Jarrett running backwards up towards the wall.
Buddy, I believe that was Jeff Bodine rather than Lake Speed. There's Lake Speed moving through.
I think it was Lake Speed that actually bumped into him.
We'll double check when we come back.
We'll look again.
It is three laps on the scoreboard here at Loudon, New Hampshire. Dale Jarrett and Dave Marcus are both able to continue.
This is Marcus is already way up high. Okay. Whip.
Yeah, see, that's Bodine. Isn't that Bodine?
Jeff Bodine, it is. Well, you see him.
Man, buddy, it's okay. It's okay. That's why we have replay.
Yep.
It looked like Dale might have checked up to keep from getting into Gordon, maybe.
Well, I mean, it's.
Who knows? Wish we had
you see Rusty. Rusty falls to the outside there. Okay. Did I?
Don't look like it hurt a bit.
Nope.
Glenn don't know.
Okay, thank you.
Was Jeff Bodine.
Yep.
Okay. Well, big monitor. next time.
No, we won't.
You see the back straightaway there? That's what we see.
Well, there is damage to the right rear on Dale's car.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, it's just
not bad. Not bad, though.
I did that last year, remember?
Thank you.
After studying the replay, have decided
that we blamed
that
it on
Mike Joy had better eyes than we did.
Oh, stop it.
It's one way to get some TV time.
Oh. Welcome back to Loudoun, New Hampshire, the Slick 5300. NASCAR may open the penalty box. Let's show you what happened here at turn three once again. Watch that 28 car.
Mike, after watching this, you were correct. It's Jeff Bodine. You can see him coming on the inside there. Rusty Wallace right on the outside. He gets into the 28 car just as they enter into the corner.
Around goes Dale Jarrett. Bodine goes under. Nice move by Rusty Wallace, but Dave Marcus.
He got collected a little bit by Elton Sawyer there.
Now, from Dave Marcus's car. Oof. Pretty close. We're about to go back to green. Here's Randy Pemberton.
Well, the 28 car has suffered a lot of damage. They have a toe-in problem or possibly toe-out. Dale has tried to work the wheel out there a little bit, get it fixed. It won't happen this caution. They've strung the car. They can't get the toe-in fixed. They're going back to green. Right now, Dale Jarrett's just going to have to ride it out until the next yellow. Glenn Jarrett, green flag.
Well, guys, that car has got a lot of history behind it. That's the same car Davey Allison drove to his last victory ever, and it's the car that Ernie Irvin set on the pole, set the track record with here last year. Good race car.
Jeff Bodine has come down pit road. Jimmy Cox has the stop sign out, and he is holding the X-Side batteries forward. We're back under green. And look at this pack. Looks like Daytona all over again with Ricky Craven in amongst Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon. Jeff Bodine will spend one lap in the penalty box as the field comes past.
You see Robert Presley in the 33 car. He's beginning to drop back just a little bit from the leaders. Looks like he's got a handling problem a little bit. You see the back end dance right there as he turns into the corner.
Back to green after an early caution involving Dale Jarrett and Jeff Bodine. Ricky Rudd right on the tail of Robert Presley as Hut Strickland moves to the outside of Jeff Gordon and Ted Musgrave.
Now there's a car that does not have a problem.
No,
he
sir.
Passed two cars in one corner on the outside. That's pretty strong.
Strickland and Musgrave, the fourth place point man, side by side. Back into the corner. Jeremy Mayfield and Dick Trickle just ahead. I think things will settle down for a few laps here.
Well, I hope so. Get a few laps under green here and kind of sort things out. See Bodine under Dick Trickle there, two wide coming off the corner there, and that's Ted Musgrave on the inside.
Folks, if you have questions during our telecast, we'd love to hear them. 1-800-451-7331 is our toll-free number. Operators in Nashville will fax your questions to us here in the booth, and we'll try to get you some answers as this telecast goes along. If you have a question about the race, dial in toll-free all during our telecast. 1-800-451-7331.
You know, it looks like Ricky Craven may have learned a little bit about the racetrack yesterday. He won the 150 here, the Busch Grand National North, and he's working over Hut Strickland. It's right there at the back of the frame there.
And Rusty Wallace moving in. And Ward Burton.
You know, I think a lot of people don't really know that they actually repaved this racetrack since last year. And they've had a couple races on it. And you know, last year, remember, the racetrack kept coming up, and, you know, it was real slick and stuff. And then now they put a sealer on it before we come this weekend. So nobody had actually run on it with the sealer, and no testing had been done or anything.
17 cautions last year. They've got a beautiful racing surface here. Yesterday in 90-degree heat, they had sprinklers out, watered the whole surface for a bit. That was on Friday, and then, of course, yesterday it rained. So should be in good shape for today. We'll be right back. Thank you.
I'm going to watch the race in a moment. Ooh, look at my man. That's who I picked, you know.
Yeah, you sure did, buddy.
I picked Bob A.
Gee, and the man you helped me pick went out of here.
Well, Ernie and I are running first and second, Mike.
Oh. Well, that would be good.
It's awfully early. Nemechek's car is coming back in this thing. He was real loose at first.
Yeah, he had got loose. He had got loose down there trying to keep from hitting somebody.
Look at Ricky Rudd coming too, though.
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by NAPA. We keep America running.
14 laps, Mark Martin leading Bobby Labonte, Joe Nemechek, Ricky Rudd in fourth, Robert Presley in fifth, Kyle Petty is sixth, Bill Elliott seventh, Rick Mast is eighth, Kenny Schrader ninth, Morgan Shepherd tenth, then Terry Labonte, Michael Waltrip, Jeff Gordon, Dale Earnhardt, and Derek Cope. Didn't take long, did it, to see who the handling cars are and who the non-handling cars are.
Yeah, we all were talking about that before the show, and you know, there's a lot of cars that were the same in practice, and you know, now we see Jeff Gordon and we see Terry Labonte, Morgan Shepherd, Kenny Schrader. You know, they all everybody looks like they're handling good, but now we're going to see what's going to happen in the next 20 laps.
That's the battle for ninth place that you're watching. Kenny Schrader in ninth, Morgan Shepherd number 21 in 10th, Labonte the number 7 of Bodine is one lap down.
You see at the back of this train right here, Jeff Gordon and Dale Earnhardt, they're moving up. They're just not in as big a hurry as we're used to seeing them come up through the crowd, because this racetrack is a give and take racetrack. You jump in there and hook somebody, you cause a huge wreck.
This group is 4.5 seconds behind the race leader.
I think this place right here, track position is going to be so, so important. You know, pit stops are going to be unbelievable important. And, you know, this race has always had that type of deal, but you know, right now the cars are so much equal. I think that now track position is going to be even more. I think we're going to see some two-tire stops. Obviously, Ricky Rudd won the race last year doing a two-tire stop, but I really think that the tires are, you know, keeping their speed for a long time. So we're going to see some two-tire stops, and pit stops are going to be critical.
This is Kenny Schrader leading this bunch. You see Morgan Shepherd looking into the inside there. I believe his car is a little bit quicker than Kenny's in the corner, but he can't get the move on him because Kenny's car is extremely strong down the straightaway.
Let's recount that of the cars involved in that incident. Dale Jarrett is still on the lead lap, but is fading. Dave Marcus is back in and amongst the fray. And here comes Earnhardt and Gordon. This would be back at 13th position.
That's Derek Cope in the 12 car there. He's run this group down and moved right up in the fray.
Now Earnhardt's actually passed Gordon because Gordon was in front of him for a while. Now Earnhardt's passed him, and it looks like Earnhardt's pulling away from Gordon. 13th place.
Pulling down on the Pennzoil Pontiac and Mike Waltrip.
See Jeff Gordon's car kind of hook a little bit there coming out of the corner. Back end jumped out just a little bit. He did lose a lap a while ago when they brought him in for that stop and go penalty.
Oh, buddy, they held him a lap. They held him until the leader went by. It was a full one lap penalty box.
Same difference.
Deal.
One lap down, I guarantee you he's fuming right now.
So now here's Earnhardt looking inside Michael Waltrip.
Also looks like
right there.
Michael,
like
give
Morgan
him
Shepherd.
Some room there. You see Michael Waltrip move out. And he knows Earnhardt, and he gets his nose up under there. He's going to go somewhere.
And Terry Labonte goes after Schrader. Makes the pass. With Shepherd now moving up into ninth place in that pack.
Schrader and Earnhardt. That's two hard hits going there, boy. They'll race this up to death. They love to race each other. Schrader might be off just a little bit. Ernie, it looks like the outside groove is going away quite a bit because the minute the Schrader got to the outside, he lost about seven or eight positions.
Yeah, I don't really think there was much of an outside groove anyway. You know, there has never been anybody running up on the outside and running fast. That's going to come in later today, I think.
So there's Schrader just outside the top 10 now. 22 laps complete. Mark Martin leads Bobby Labonte, Joe Nemechek, Robert Presley, and Ricky Rudd, the top five. We'll be right back. Derek Cope started 23rd.
Yeah, he's running well. We need to give him all. He hadn't had anything said about him all year.
The beginning of the year, they ran real good.
Now, Jan Lady found that outside groove yesterday, and he kicked around pretty good there. That was
here comes Derek by Gordon.
Gordon not handling just right yet. You got him? You're not giving money away yet, are you? Okay. Keep the faith.
Who does?
They're about to go a lap down.
Thank you.
That car is not working well at all right now.
Which one?
28.
No.
Seven laps complete here at Loudoun, New Hampshire. Here's a look at your top 10 in the Slick 5300. Down through Terry Labonte in 10th place and down through Dick Trickle running in 20th. Bobby Labonte had been right on Mark Martin's bumper until the last time they went into turn number one, where Mark opened up about three car lengths on Bobby, whose car pushed up to the high group between one and two.
Mike, a lot of times when you go in the corner, Ernie can verify this, you go in so hard that the car will not stick and it goes right on out to the outside, and you can see the outside groove is not the place to be right now, so he lost quite a bit of ground there.
I tell you, you know, they put a sealer on this racetrack yesterday or a couple, 3 days ago, and, you know, everybody started running. Well, nobody really ran the high groove, so obviously more of the sealer that gets wore off on the bottom groove gets faster. Top group doesn't have the sealer wore off yet.
Now they have just overlapped Dale Jarrett, whose car was involved in that initial lap spin. There you see the right rear of Jarrett's car, the spoiler and deck lid pushed up, the bumper a bit askew. Other than that, Randy Pemberton, what's wrong with Dale Jarrett's car?
Well, I can tell you it's a somber bunch down here in the 28. The 28 crew is Larry McReynolds. We know you had some damage. What is it, and can you fix it?
Well, I think we can, Randy. We're going to have a caution to fix it. It sure would have been nice to have got one before the leaders got back to us. The right front wheel's towed out about 3 inches. Again, we can fix it, I think, but we need a caution to do it.
Okay, that's the report from Larry McReynolds.
Jarrett, after the spin, backed into the wall, and that may have come around and caught up with the right front as well. Watch that 8 car tail end of that pack. See a little bit of smoke coming out the back of Jeff Burton's Raybestos Ford. as he goes into the corner, dissipates when he comes off the corner behind Hut Strickland, Vic Trickle, and Jerry Mayfield. Now there's a touch of it there, just coming up from under.
Well, Mike, if it don't get any worse than that, but the bad part is it's so early in the race to have any kind of leak that eventually you're going to use up whatever that is that's smoking. We don't speculate up here, but we certainly don't know.
I tell you, that race team right there really had a tough time this year. I was talking to somebody this morning, and they haven't been in the top. They've only ran in the top 18 one time. I mean, so they've had a tough go of it.
Burton's crew thinks it's a valve cover leaking, valve cover gasket.
You can see everybody lapping over Dale Jarrett there. When the front tire is towed out 3 inches like that, that's just like dragging the whole car down the straightaway. It just won't come up to speed, and I know he's wishing for caution right now.
Gordon Shepherd goes past, so Jarrett joins Jeff Bodine and being one lap down. 33 of 300 laps complete. Just two cars off the lead lap.
Morgan Shepherd there. He's chasing Earnhardt through the corner. He looks like he's running quite well today. He said he was this morning when I talked to him. Morgan Shepherd said he was really getting through the corners good. And as you know, this racetrack is all corner. I mean, that's where you really set up to get the straightaway speed that makes it count.
Mike Wallace and the Heilig Myers Ford, whose name has been mentioned with several top rides for next season. Now driving for Jimmy Donlevy, and he'll go a lap down to Mark Martin.
You know, rumors are funny. This man owns part of this race team. Junie Donlevy gave him part of that race team. I'm not sure he's going anywhere.
I'm not either. But you hear some strange things this time of year.
Definitely.
Jeremy Mayfield caught on the outside in the RCA Ford of Cale Yarborough, and those other three Fords freight train by him. Now Ricky Craven in a Chevrolet drops to the inside. He's not going to get there this time.
Oh, we have one in the wall, the 22 car, oh. Jimmy Hensley.
That's the Bill Davis, MBNA Pontiac, bringing out the second caution flag of the day, right between turns 1 and 2.
See Jimmy coming out. He's got his window net down. He's getting out of the car right now. Trying to get everything unhooked. When you start getting out and all those radio connections and everything, you have to get all that unhooked before you can jump out.
Hensley, two races ago, replaced rookie Randy LaJoy in the Bill Davis Pontiac. And he's had a pretty hard lick into the wall. Gets out under his own power and waits for attention. Should see pit stops here.
Must have cut a tire down or something. It sure seems like. You know, now, yeah, again, remember, pit stops are going to be really critical right now. And, you know, the fastest pit crews are the ones that are going to, you know, benefit from this.
And as we've said, track position is so critical. The quickest crews, a lot easier to pass somebody when they're stopped on pit road than out there on the racetrack.
Yeah, that's for sure. Jimmy's still sitting there.
Well, he's okay. Looks like he just had a little bit of the wind knocked out of him.
And we look like we got pit stops coming. It looks like everybody's going to come.
Mark Martin leads the fleet down pit road. Mike Wallace and Jeff Bodine stay out as they are not on the lead lap. They cannot pit this time.
I bet you we'll see some two-tire stops. You know, obviously, they're all pitting, so we're not going to be able to spot them all.
Here's Glenn.
Mark Martin comes in. He's been talking with Steve Mill about a slight chassis adjustment. They were only talking about maybe a pound of air added to the right rear. So evidently the car might be just a little bit too tight for Mark. But other than that, I see no signs of any chassis adjustment. So anything they did with air pressure. Randy?
Well, Jeff Gordon went for a two-tire stop. He's down and away. Rusty Wallace is out. The 28 car is in. They're working on the rear end and the front end of Dale Jarrett's car. He's in for a lengthy stay. He'll probably just beat the pace car out.
Here's how they came off pit road. Mark, or rather, Jeff Gordon out first. Mark Martin out second. Bobby Labonte. Then Robert Presley, Joe Nemechek, Ricky Rudd, Terry Labonte, Morgan Shepherd, and Rusty Wallace. We'll be right back to Loudoun, New Hampshire after this. Okay. Yeah, that's what.
Oh, for us or you?
Huh?
For us or no?
No.
Nah,
just wanted to know if
you're okay. Oh, okay. Okay. Black flagging the 18. Why? Oh, wrench in it? Okay. Wrench left in the 18.
Oh, man.
Oh, there it
you
is.
You talk about something bad now. Come out in third. Go ahead.
Yes, I do, Pam. Okay. Okay. Are you taping a little of this? Okay. Can we go from the lead? Can we go from the lead? Pan back to him and show the wrench, and he will. It show that he'll lose third place when he comes around.
I know that's not my job, man.
That's fine, man. That's fine. Peachy.
Bobby Labonte has to be ready to kill. This is the, I mean, you talk about track position.
Oh, good, and it's bright yellow so everybody can see it. Sorry, Bobby.
Oh, my. We don't have a NASCAR radio with him, do we?
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by RCA, changing entertainment again.
A slip of the grip and bad luck for Bobby Labonte. They had a great pit stop. They got Bobby back out in third place, but they left a wrench in the car, the one they used to adjust the jacking bolt. Look at the top of the left rear of the rear window. And there is that ratchet and the extension that turns that jacking screw. Mechanic takes it off, tosses it over the wall, and Bobby Labonte will restart tail end. Here's
wow.
Glenn.
Well, you're looking at the wrench here. So Jimmy Makar is talking to his driver, Bobby Labonte. Of course, Jimmy is the crew chief on the car. We'll let them finish their conversation, and we'll get a word with him to see just exactly what they're going to do to. Jimmy, awfully tough break, but nothing you can do now but take your time getting back.
No, it was kind of a miscommunication here in the pits. We made a tire pressure change, and one of the guys thought we meant rounds and put a wedge wrench in the car to make the round change, and nobody made a change.
Saw you talking to Bobby there. You trying to calm him down or just tell him to take it easy?
No, he's okay. We just kind of go over what we got to do, starting at the back. Kind of going to be a little tough now. We'll have to be calm and take our time, get to the front, but kind of be cautiously aggressive. So. We got a lot of time left in the race. I think we'll be okay. We just have to stay out of trouble.
Awfully smart thinking there. They got an awfully good race car today.
They do, Glenn, but as you look at the top 10, buddy, two drivers that I've never known anybody had to calm down, the Labonte brothers.
They're pretty cool.
They are cool customers. The 28 car pitted with the cars on the lead lap, so he must restart at the tail end of the longest line, and that line is 38 cars long. Cars on the lead lap. Jeff Gordon has now led 15 of the 16 races this year, has 110 bonus points. You get 5 points if you lead a lap during the race, and the driver who leads the most laps gets an additional 5 points. We'll try to give you those stats in response to one of our 800 calls. We have it at the end of the day. We're ready to go back to green. Lap 41, green flag flying. Jeff Gordon hauls him down to turn one. That's Jeff Bodine, number 7, trying to get back on the lead lap as Mark Martin carries you into turn one. Bodine got a good run up off the corner, got right to Gordon's bumper and no further.
It's not quite over yet. He's looking on the inside.
Whoa.
He makes a move going into turn three there.
A bold move by Jeff Bodine. Whoa. Here comes Mark Martin trying to take the lead. Almost took our in-car camera right there as he got up against Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, Jeff got tagged just a little bit there, but Mark was already up under him. It was not meant to happen like that.
So Bodine is back on the lead lap, and Martin is back in the lead. Glenn?
Well, Mike, one of the reasons that Jeff Gordon decided to take on only two tires while the rest of the guys took four was track position. They wanted it very, very badly. They knew they could get up to the front of the pack and maybe not lose too many on the restart. Ray Evernham told him, Jeff, it's going to be a little loose in the center of the corner. Just take it easy. We'll gain in the long run by doing this.
Thanks, Glenn. Pretty much single file back through the field.
Hutch Strickland and Kyle Petty racing side by side. Hutch not able to make any positions on the outside there. He'll have to stay on the bottom until they work that groove up later on in the race.
To underscore Glenn's point, Jeff Gordon came into the pits 12th on that caution flag and came out first. Ricky Craven and Todd Bodine and Ward Burton, the 31, the Hardy's car battle.
See Ward Burton there taking a look. Running there with Slater on the inside of the racetrack. And you can see that outside lane. He lost about three car lengths. Here comes Ward Burton making it three wide down the back straightaway as they go towards turn three.
Slater had to check up coming off turn two to keep from getting into Strickland, and Ward Burton drives on past.
Well, this is a give and take, and I guarantee you if I'd have been in third lane, I'd have been given.
Second helping for Ward Burton. As he moves up now, Ricky Craven, the Kodiak Chevy, number 41 on the inside, pulls underneath Hutch Strickland. Ooh, they bump, whoa, they bang, and Strickland goes around in the fence gently. A long ride for the Quaker State Ford of Hutch Strickland. Will he sit there to draw the caution? No, he pulls away, and he didn't hit it all that gently.
No, that's pretty, you know, anytime you touch a concrete wall, it's backed up by the state of New Hampshire here. Yes. So when you pop it, it's going to bend some stuff.
We stay under green.
Well, Mark Martin's making this look pretty easy right now. That car's doing everything he wants, but you see, everybody's not doing everything they can do right now. There's Jeff Bodine just in front of him. He's back in the lead lap now. And he actually passed the lead car.
Let's show you what happened to Hutch Strickland. There's Ricky Craven, 41. Strickland is the other green car, 26.
Okay, you see Ricky right on the bottom there. They just make contact getting into the corner. There was nowhere for Ricky to go. He had the left front as far down next to that yellow line as he could go.
He lost about four positions. And Hutch Strickland got into the fence and is now on pit road. Randy's right there.
Well, Hutch damage looks at least as bad as Dale Jarrett. The trunk buckled in underneath the rear tires. Hard to see if the frame is bent underneath. It might be okay, but they've lost now two laps. They've changed four tires. Hutch stalls the car, leaving pit road. They've got a little work to do on the next pit stop. He'll ride around so they can get her back in here.
One of the few disappointments they've had since Strickland has joined that team.
You know, that's a lot like the wreck that they had at Michigan when, you know, Ricky Rudd kind of come down on him, you know. It's just part of racing, I guess.
Rusty Wallace and Rick Mass battle. There's Bill Elliott with Ted Musgrave, Derek Cope, Dale Earnhardt, and the 30 car of Michael Waltrip. We'll be back to New Hampshire International Speedway after this.
Jeff Gordon's coming, coming, coming. Of course, he's being held up right now. Mark is. You know who's really moving right now? Not Rusty Wallace.
Yep. Rusty was good in practice.
Okay. Whip. Pow.
Is Mark Martin going to go by him?
He's going to try.
Not going to quite get
him. He's not going to make it. I bet Mark's saying,
why do I have to do this?
Yeah.
Look at Robert Presley. We hadn't mentioned him. He's really on the move. He was dropping back before he made that stop.
Derek. 31 right there. That was pretty gruesome looking.
That was a wreck.
That pack.
Just never happened. Now if you pull down, you're done. Mike Wallace in a very bad spot.
The Winston Cup cars. Right. And if they ran the outside a lot in yesterday's race, I wonder if that's some of that, that's why the outside's so bad.
Might be, you know, because they, like I said, they put a sealer down first. Mm-hmm. Now the Hoosiers were
look
a different
Kyle, he was all the way on the flat.
Last year, I, you know, led a lot of this race, and I run all four tires underneath that yellow line almost all the time until finally
the race. That was the place to be.
Five laps complete in the Slick 5300 here live in New Hampshire. Mark Martin in front of the field. Jeff Bodine there on the tail end of the lead lap in number 7. Show you another look at what happened from Sterling Marlin's car. And Marlin was one of four cars that went by Craven and Strickland. Marlin running 20th, Earnhardt 13th, Gordon is second. Those are the 3-point leaders. And look at the right side of your screen there. Robert Presley just behind the two leaders. What a great run the rookie driver is having for Leo Jackson today. Let's go to his pit.
Well, guys, one of the reasons that he may be doing so well so early is that Robert has had more experience on this racetrack than anybody else here. He ran all the Busch Series races. So, Charlie, is that a lot to do with it, the experience that Robert has here?
I think it has a lot to do with it. He came here with a good setup. Guys back in the shop gave him a good car. Robert put a good setup under it. It's looking pretty good right now.
Well, it certainly is. Of course, this is Charlie Presley, Robert's brother and crew chief. And next door to them is Joe Nemechek. Joe also has a lot of experience on this racetrack. It seems to be paying off early here for those young guys.
That's right, fans. Remember that when Bob Baer built this super speedway, he ran Busch Grand National Racing for several years before NASCAR would grant him a Winston Cup date. So the drivers who ran those races may have an edge here today. Presley trails Ricky Craven by 1 point in the Rookie of the Year chase. John Andretti moving up on Sterling Marlin.
There's Jimmy Spencer. He's on the move right now. He's up under Ricky Craven getting in that corner. He's just behind these cars that we're looking at. This Dick Trickle. And I noticed a while ago that Sterling Marlin's car, when we had the in-car camera on it, he's running those headers again that everybody was talking about in Daytona.
Now, Ron Pittman said those were only for Daytona and Talladega.
Yeah, but you know how motors men are.
No, how are they?
They'll tell you a fib.
Ron Pittman would not do that. Here's your Napa Field standing update. Napa, we keep America running. Here's how they're running at 58 laps. We had an 800 call about gas mileage. We estimate about 5 miles per gallon for the Winston Cup cars. And I asked Rutt Pittman that one day at Daytona. I said, can you make it on fuel? And he says, heck. He says, this thing gets better gas mileage than my wife's station wagon.
Yeah.
Glad I don't drive her station wagon.
Tell her if it takes water right now. Tell her it's all good solid, bro. Get it.
Now, that's the interplay between the 37 car of John Andretti and the 4 car of Sterling Marlin. A little horse training going on up here to our right on the roof. We're going to talk to the spotter for Dick Trickle.
For the 15 car.
Try to work something out. There goes Andretti.
Good to Fowlery.
Boy, Andretti's running very well. He passed Sterling like he was stopped going in turn 3 over there.
20th place. And Jimmy Spencer. The camel car just behind Marlin's Kodak machine. 60 laps are complete here at the Magic Mile in Loudoun, New Hampshire, and Mark Martin has been in front for most of them. We'll be right back with you live on TNN.
We keep America running. Oh, my ear. Man. caught with the sensor. He's rooting and gouging every once in a while. But yeah, that's just fixing to say that'd be a good car to watch. He's fixing that.
Yeah. Jimmy's going to get most obvious performance right here.
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by the more than 1,000 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts.
Sterling Marlins dropped a few spots from when we left. Jimmy Spencer just sliced underneath him, and so did Bobby Hamilton in the STP Pontiac just ahead. So Marlin continues to drop a few positions, not going to aid him in his quest to stay 7 points ahead of Jeff Gordon and 16 ahead of Dale Earnhardt. He has slipped to 23rd. As Jimmy Spencer continues to move forward, passing Dick Trickle.
Don't do it.
What Buddy Baker was saying was, please,
clear,
Dick Trickle, don't
clear.
Pull down. There you hear the spotters, they're saying clear, you know. When the car goes by and the spotter sees that they're clear, they'll tell him clear.
Bobby Hamilton there, the car is right on the bottom of the racetrack. It's handling quite well. He and Spencer really moved up in the past couple of laps.
Ooh, look at Marlin pulled out on Bobby Hamilton getting into the corner. Once again, if you have questions for us, give us a call here at TNN. Questions about today's race, toll free 1-800-451-7331. John from New York wants to know, what's the difference between the helmet these drivers wear and his motorcycle helmet?
Actually, the motorcycle helmet would be basically the same thing we would wear in a race car. Now, I don't know what his motorcycle helmet actually is, but we wear a Simpson helmet. Most all the Winston Cup guys do. And, you know, they're usually, most of us all wear a full-face Simpson helmet.
My guess, John, the major differences are the D-rings are a little different shape for a cycle helmet. They got flat sides instead of round ones. There's a fire retardant interior in the racing helmet. The racing helmet has a Snell Foundation sticker that it's been inspected and approved.
Right.
So that's the big difference.
And the one thing I love the best is the fresh air duct in the side.
Yes.
I'm going to tell you, with the full-face helmet, you have to have some air in there.
I tell you, they've got some words going around with Jimmy Spencer. He really been loose off the corner a couple times, and I think he's just about sideswiped the fence there a little bit, but he's really running good.
Jimmy runs one way. Wide open.
No, yeah. No, it's two ways. Oh. Wide open, half turned over all the time.
Mr. Excitement, they named him when he ran the modifieds and won the national championship. Won two races last year, Daytona and Talladega in July. Here's Bill Elliott running in 10th place in the McDonald's Ford. Leading a pack that includes the Family Channel Ford of Ted Musgrave, the main and tail Ford, almost losing part of that tail with Derek Cope. And the man in black, the Goodwrench Chevy, seven-time champion Dale Earnhardt.
You can see Dale got just about up where Derek Cope would know he's there, but not quite. And Dale had to check up a little bit, but he's come right back across it on the front of the three car.
I tell you, you remember last year, you know, I led a lot of this race and actually had put Dale Earnhardt a lap down because he wasn't running all that well. And you can't ever count Dale Earnhardt out. He'll work on their car. They'll work on their car. Next thing you know, Dale Earnhardt gets his lap back. Pretty soon he's in lead and racing for the win.
Earnhardt didn't win that race. Ricky Rudd did. But to me, that was one of Earnhardt's most impressive drives of all last season to come. He lost a lap in less than 100 laps, maybe
right.
60 laps.
I think it was about 60 laps.
I think you're right. And then came back and was a contender.
Speaking of contenders, right there in the 16th car, Ted Musgrave, I don't know if anybody has had a better year than he's had. He's so consistent. Don't count him out of the points race yet.
He's in fourth, 110 points out of the lead. Trouble on Dick Trickle's car. The engine may have let go. A lot of smoke out of turn two. Trickle drops to the inside. Tough day for Bud Moore's team.
Great run in Daytona. Got shuffled around on the restart there. I think he was running in seventh and got into the wall a little bit. And some cars helped him get over into it and ended up back way back in the field there. But they had a great run all day.
You can see Jeff Gordon working on Mark Martin. Jeff Gordon only took two tires on him. So that's going to tell all these guys in the pits that, you know, man, maybe we only maybe have to put two on. So next stop, the majority of the guys will probably put two on. Jeff Gordon's probably going to have to put four on. So where his advantage, he got back to the front this time. Now the advantage is going to be away from him a little bit.
But now they know that a two-tire stop works, and it really doesn't hurt them badly.
Right.
Dick Trickle's car on pit road with the hood up. Bobby Labonte, who had that penalty, has gained only 9 spots since the restart. And we'll be right back to Loudoun, New Hampshire after this. Okay.
Big boomers.
Big movers. Movers.
The movers,
buddy.
Oh.
Not boomers.
I thought you said big boomers. Oh, please, give me a break.
I think we've shown most
Where
of
Where is Bobby Labonte at now?
I do. He's 7 seconds from going a lap down.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. That's track position.
Yep.
You want to make an argument about
Ooh,
it.
Dale Jarrett and Bodine side by side. Ooh, turn four. Ooh, ooh.
Good clean driving.
Yes. Just what we would expect.
I don't think it's done yet.
Yes, it is. Proud of him.
Thank you.
If Jeff Bodine gets a caution flag, he's as fast as the leaders. Maybe a little faster.
Yeah. What do you hear about all the stuff on Junior's cars?
Look at Mark using that headrest with that helmet. It's
dumb stuff.
Look at it working.
Yeah.
Mark, he just lays in there.
Welcome back to Loudoun, New Hampshire International Speedway. Mike Joy with Buddy Baker and Ernie Irvin. Randy Pemberton, Glenn Jarrett on pit road for TNN today. Mark Martin continues to hold sway. Remember the penalty to Bobby Labonte? He is only 5 seconds on the racetrack from going a lap down. That penalty really cost him. Track position, as we've said at the top of the day, is everything here. Labonte came out of the pits third. Had to stop to remove a jacking bolt wrench, had to restart 38th. Now, may be in trouble because here come the leaders.
Well, the same people he's trying to pass, though, the leaders have to go by now. The only thing they do have is the advantage of the flagman working with them to move the lap over cars out of the way. So there's always an advantage to be on the lead lap.
I'll tell you, Buddy Baker brought up a good point. If Jeff Bodine gets back in the lead lap, which he's on the lead lap now, but he's actually outrunning Mark Martin right now. So if he can get back, get a caution, and get to come back around, he's going to be a contender today.
Chuck Bowne about to be overlapped by the race leader. Mark Martin, very interesting sponsor on Bowne's car underneath active race. I'm not sure we can get a shot of it, but I'll tell you about it. Now here's Gordon underneath Bowne. Gets it by. There's Bowne. David McCorriston of Bristol, Connecticut was taking his girlfriend through the garage area today and under active racing where it says, Connie, will you marry me, David? Connie Russo said yes. What a way to propose on the side of a Winston Cup stock car.
Huh, that is neat.
So Connie and David, best of luck. Hope the marriage lasts longer than the sheet metal on most of these cars. Pretty neat deal.
see Steve Griffin going a lap down there. There's Mark Martin, and you see Jeff Gordon. He only changed two tires, but he may have had a handling problem that they figured if they just changed the right sides, it would really make the car better. So a lot of times you do that. Instead of taking on four tires, you take on the right sides and maybe loosen the car up just a little bit.
Let's go back to the battle for fifth place, where Robert Presley's trying to hold off Terry Labonte. Labonte seventh in the point standings at this halfway juncture. And Presley battling Ricky Craven for Rookie of the Year. Presley started outside pole today.
Well, if Terry Labonte gets by him, it would do Robert Presley proud just to follow this guy because he knows where that winner's circle is.
And here comes Rusty Wallace, who has come from 20th on the starting grid to sixth place today.
Like I said, Rusty was one of the real good cars in practice. And you see Rusty's line through the corner. I mean, he's going in real low, and he's coming all the way around the corner and right near the apron.
Ernie, he's within a half car length to getting as low as you run here.
Now, last year I ran really, really low, but the problem was is the outside, the racetrack was breaking up. 90% of the cars would run the outside like that. I would run real low on the apron. Well, what happened was is I was the one running it, and it ended up breaking the inside up too, so the groove went away. So I got passed by a couple guys, and I had to change my groove.
Talking about breaking it up, as we were talking just then, Rusty Wallace just went by Labonte like he was stopped.
Well, I think Labonte, once Rusty got the bottom, looked like Terry let him go. Yeah. Labonte is one of those drivers who picks his battles.
Yeah, he'll fight you later.
Right, right. It's like, I don't have to fight you now, but I'm going to be back and get you later.
I think he fights you when it counts.
That's it.
I think the old saying is, you want to fight? No, but I'm going to. That's Bill Elliott there. He's getting by Mike Wallace. Mike's just a little bit off on the corner time. Here comes Earnhardt making it three wide, which is not unusual.
And
Ted Musgrave stick that car right on that yellow line.
Which Derek Cope right there in the main and tail Ford. His car's been running really good today, too.
Yeah, Cope came 23rd on the starting grid. He's now in 13th.
Michael Waltrip in the 30 car there.
And his name has been dropped into the rumor mill about next season.
He's been in the rumor mill for the past 10 years. Chuck Ryder likes him. He's a good race car driver. He's going to win sooner or later. He's good enough to win.
Dick Trickle's back in the race after Bud Moore's crew repaired a broken power steering line. Presley and Wallace, the 93 winner. Dale Jarrett involved in a crash early on and is now, let's see, two laps down. At 88 laps, Mark Martin leads Jeff Gordon, Joe Nemechek, Robert Presley, the rookie, Rusty Wallace, Terry Labonte, and Morgan Shepherd.
Him loose, Rusty, off that corner. Ooh, we make him earn it. You see him on the steering
wheel? See it, Rusty?
Boop. Yep. Yep. He won't mess with you very long, either.
No.
He'll give him about three or four times.
He's getting ready to get him right now.
I don't know. Presley's car is a rocket ship down
the
straightaway. Right here is where Rusty's flying. Right, watch where he picks the throttle up here. Look.
There he goes. He's going to bat him down.
Always in commercial. Only the satellite fans see it.
Ooh. Terry said, I got a man. Just make a big hole for me to go through.
Yeah.
Look here. The pass in the grass. Soon to come. Nope. Where's Earnhardt now?
11th. 10th. 9 seconds back. I heard seconds back.
Uh-oh, she's doing it again.
Thank you.
Uh-oh.
Now glad I didn't say that.
Sarcasm.
No.
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately?
92 laps complete here at Loudon. Mark Martin continues to lead Jeff Gordon. Joe Nemechek having one of the best runs of his Winston Cup career in third as we watch this battle from ninth on back. Make it 10th on back. There's Bill Elliott in 10th, Ted Musgrave 11th, Derek Cope in 12th, Michael Waltrip is 13th. Things among this group have kind of evened out. But up here, Rusty Wallace had moved past Terry Labonte. Now goes after Joe Nemechek. Third place at stake here.
Not for long.
Nope. Wallace moves on by. Nemechek's gotten into the right place.
He needs to take a lead to beat the tape off. He's braked up. Brakes are starting to get hot.
That's Rusty.
He's a field general. When he's out there, he'll tell him, I want 1 pound out of the right front. I want this on the rear spoiler. Do this, do that. All the way through the race. I mean, he is calling the shots for everything they do on this race car.
Now here's Labonte's gotten past Nemechek. Kellogg's car up a notch and back into the top five.
I have to say Rusty's one of the fastest cars on the racetrack. You know, he went by the 33, he went by the 5, and you know, he's really running real well today.
Dale Jarrett's made a stop for four tires. And you're riding with Dave Marcus, looking back to Elton Sawyer. Robert Harrington, one of the top longtime crew chiefs in this sport, asked me to pass along a thank you to all the folks up here. He said the hospitality we've been shown by even the people who parked the cars, everybody at the racetrack, the folks at the hotels, everybody has been, he said, it's like it used to be down south with old-fashioned southern hospitality up here in the Lakes region of New Hampshire. He thought that was pretty neat.
Well, we do too.
I tell you, we noticed that when we come in and out of the garage and we come in and out of the tunnel. I mean, even the tunnel guy, he acted like he was having a fun time parking the cars and stuff today.
On your outside.
It's not often you have that. Here goes Rusty Wallace trying to get by Dave Marcus on the outside.
And you're listening to Marcus's radio communication with his crew and spotter. Yeah, there are a lot of race fans up here. You'd never know it to read some of the major daily papers here that insist on covering stick and ball sports that draw about a quarter of the attendance that's here today, but that's the way it goes.
I talked to Roger Bear that owns the racetrack. He told me that he had requests for at least 40,000 more seats.
Gosh.
I mean, he could have sold 40,000 more seats, but they can't get them in and out of here. I mean, this is like the maximum you can get in here. And, you know, he would put more grandstands up because, I tell you, it's a really, really pretty place. And they've done a great job with it.
Ted Goddard here, who handles the facilities, told me this morning, he said, we've added 22 acres of parking. It's all used up. He said, we're going to have to work out how to shuttle people from Concord and from Laconia to ease the parking problem. And he says the biggest problem they have right now is so many people come to the racetrack, one person to a car. If they could alleviate that, it would ease traffic congestion coming and going, and they'd be intimate for people there,
for sure.
Here's a traffic jam in the making.
Derek Cope making a move on Ted Musgrave there. Derek Cope is running very, very well today, and I look for them sometime during the year to really do something special because that's a good race team. It's Bobby Allison's race team.
Looked like Joe Nemechek had his loose problem back again from the time when you were mentioning it at the beginning of the race.
Report we have on Nemechek's car is that the brakes had been heating up and become ineffective, so he eased the car for a few laps, get a little more brake and pedal back in it. The and then was able to go back after and pick up a spot or two.
Yeah, that's not a good feeling, especially here. As long as the straightaways aren't as flat as the corners are, the brake pedal starts getting spongy, and you start pumping about halfway down the straightaway to get enough pedal built up just to get in the corner. Not a good feeling.
So at 101 laps, there's your leaders, Mark Martin and Jeff Gordon, the Valvoline Ford and the DuPont Chevrolet. We'll be back to New Hampshire International Speedway live on TNN after this.
I believe my predictions may fall today.
Ernie's looking pretty smart.
Yeah. Well, Bobby Labonte's holding his own. He stayed about the same, but that track position killed him.
He's still sick. He's speeded up. He's 6.5 seconds from going right now. What's fine?
So he's running good still.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, that track position, everything here.
Sterling Marlin not running very well today.
No, he's got motor.
Okay, thank you.
I think.
He's what?
He's not running down straightaway, it don't look like.
No. Oh, here's a good one. What is the penalty box?
Let me see what he's turning.
Says Courtney, who has never been to a hockey game.
He does not have an engine problem. He's just turning 8,400.
Who?
Sterling.
Okay.
Gordon on them two tires still staying right with Mark.
Okay, that or a bunch of trailers.
Yep, that'll have something to do with the ladders.
It'll be
when
it'll
they
be,
come down yeah. to the end. A lot of people just take
everybody
on
be
two.
Two.
Yeah,
it'll be interesting to see what Gordon and them do now because they're going to have to.
Can we get some strategy from those two pits? From the pits of 6 and 24.
Gordon will have to change left side.
Yeah,
he'll have to change left side. So
they'd
time.
Have to change four almost.
Yeah,
that'd be my guess. Oh, baby. Look at Strickland. He's still running good with that thing all bent up.
Yep. Always three down. Three laps down. Welcome back to Loudoun, New Hampshire, the Slick 5300 live on the Nashville Network. For information on Featherlight trailers, call 1-800-800-1230. Featherlight, official trailer of NASCAR. Tense moment for Mark Martin as he tried to get past Jeff Burton right between turns 1 and 2, thought better of it, and cracked the throttle. Jeff Gordon just one car length behind the race leader, Ford versus Chevrolet here.
Mike, that's what makes Mark Martin the driver that he is. He never makes a mistake that takes him out of a race. It's give and take, and he knows it. He gets in there a little hot, and it might be a wreck. He'll back off long enough to get everybody straight again.
We've had several questions about our in-car cameras and how they are chosen and why Mark Martin always seems to have one. Well, the folks that sponsor that car, they obtain or purchase an in-car camera from TNN for every Winston Cup race we televise. Other sponsors do so likewise. In fact, on all the cable network telecasts, the in-car cameras are sold to the car sponsor. But, well, we say sold. They cover the cost of installing and operating the camera and the helicopter that hovers above the racetrack to transmit the pictures from the race car, bounce off the helicopter, and then down to the Boykin communications truck next to our TNN truck where you get these great pictures from.
You can see Jeff Burton's car there getting really sideways just in front of Mark Martin. I bet Mark's going, you know, I'd like to do something here pretty quick because it looks like the A car is just a little bit off. You see the back end of the car jump around right there.
Now, did he wave Mark to the inside?
No, I don't think so. Didn't look like it.
No.
Thought I saw a wave. Guess not. Well, pit stops will be coming up when, Glenn?
Well, guys, I mean, Mark Martin's pits, they're expecting him in on the next lap. They gave him about a three-lap interval a while ago. They said, they told me lap 110. They may go to lap 111. They're going to go with four tires. They're going to obviously fuel. They're going to make a slight adjustment on the car. It was a little bit tight. They made it a little too loose to Mark's liking, believe it or not, even though he continues to lead a little bit loose. But very slight adjustment, put it back like it was when the race started. Randy?
Well, they're starting to rush around in Jeff Gordon's pit. I went up to Ray Everingham. No strategy there. They got to take four tires to run in second. Two tires will do you no good right now. You still got almost 200 laps left. The two car, Robin Pemberton and the guys, they're talking about when they're going to pit. They're also going to take on four tires. Really no chassis adjustments to speak of down here, Glenn.
I think there'll be wholesale pit stops next time by. I see nine crews standing on the wall holding Jackson tires and ready to jump. So pit stops are imminent. Boy, if Mark stops, that's a break for Jeff Burton and Jeremy Mayfield.
Momentarily it is anyhow, but yep. They have to stop pretty quick too. Even though they're just about to go a lap down, they're still running quite well.
We all have the same amount of gas, right?
That's it.
Seventh and eighth place, the Winston Cup champion and the defending champion of this race. Jeff Bodine surrenders his tail end of the lead lap position to become the first car to make a green flag stop in this round. And he will get four tires on his Xside 4. Derek Culp, the straight arrow main and tail Ford, is also in. Ooh, Jeff Burton.
I thought he'd cut a tire just for a second. Looked like Jeff Burton was going straight there. Here comes Mark Martin down the pit road as we speak.
And Jeff Gordon stays out. So Mark Martin comes down toward Steve Meehl and the crew. Lap 113, if you're keeping tally at home. Pit board is also out for Kyle Petty as Derek Culp completes his service. Let's go to Glenn.
Well, guys, as Mark Martin pulls down into the pits, they told us he was going to put on four tires. That's so we'd say that, and all the other teams would hear that. Now they have decided to go with the right side tires only. So after they got everybody else's attention and said four, they're going to put on two right sides, send him down and away. They like the idea of what Jeff Gordon did. The right sides are on, he's down and away. Randy?
Well, they're waiting for Jeff Gordon. I'll tell you, that is a funny thing that they did. Two tires. It does put the pressure on these guys down here. The two right side tires going around. They're loosening the left side lug nuts, no doubt about it. They're going four. Robin Pemberton also waiting for Rusty Wallace. These guys wanted to pick up five bonus points, both Jeff Gordon as well as the two car. The left side tire is going on the 24 car right now. Good pit stop, shouldn't go lap down, but Jeff Gordon away 17th flat. Wow, these guys are cooking in the pits. They're waiting for Rusty Wallace to come down pit road.
Great stop for Gordon. Musgrave got four tires. Kyle Petty is getting four. Brett Bodine is in. So is Jeremy Mayfield. Ward Burton has four tires. Ricky Craven, Steve Grissom, the 23 of Jimmy Spencer. And let's go to Randy at Rusty Wallace.
No wedge wrenches for Rusty Wallace. Right side tires already on, coming around. Scott Robinson with a jack. One pump, car up in the air. This looks like a good stop so far as well for Rusty. Gas is in, down and away. Another great stop on pit road.
16-5.
Wow. I used to take that long to get it out of neutral and get it in low gear. That's incredible.
Now remember, that they've changed some of the pit road rules at the beginning of the year this year. So most of the stops were 20 seconds, 19-5 and stuff like that. Now they're back to going 16-5, 17 flat.
Rich Bickle's been in. Joe Nemechek is in. So is Rick Mast. Here's Terry Labonte coming down the pit lane. Mike Wallace has completed his stop. Todd Bodine is in as well. And Robert Presley is in. Here's Randy.
Well, the boys for the Kellogg's Cornflake Machine on the wall, poised and ready for Terry Labonte to hit his mark. Labonte brings it in nice and smooth, doesn't lock him up at all. Walter Smith with a jack, puts the Kellogg Chevy up in the air, automatic four-tire stop. You wonder what this is going to do to the strategy of Mark Martin right now. Around to the left side, jack is up once again. Labonte having a good stop, not as good as Martin's or Gordon's or Wallace's, it appears. He's down and away.
19.1 seconds for Terry Labonte. Here's Glenn.
Presley's pit. Well, we got a problem in Robert Presley's pit. He came in for a two-tire change, and he stalled the engine. Something happened. It fluttered. I don't know if he was out of fuel or what. They sprayed some starting fluid in it, and it helped it start it back up, but he lost valuable time. The time that he might have gained with the two-tire change was wasted by the car stalling. Tough break for Robert Presley. He's still got a good race car, though.
And here's your leader. Dale Earnhardt and Ricky Rudd have yet to pit, as does Morgan Shepherd.
I tell you, I still think what Mark Martin and them did was a smart thing. I mean, you know, take two tires on a green flag, you know, and make sure you can get some more guys a lap down.
Well, that was obvious what Earnhardt wanted. He wanted those 5 points for leading the lap right there, and he'll probably be coming in pretty quick now.
Well, that point battle is tight enough that those 5 points could be very important come season's end. Bobby Hamilton is in the STP Pontiac. So is Sterling Marlin, the Kodak Chevrolet, the Span Ford of Lake Speed. Coming in for its stop. Four tires for Sterling Marlin and four for Bobby Hamilton. Lane called in from Connecticut. Must have seen that cover story in Forbes magazine this week. Wants to know if it's possible to buy stock in NASCAR.
They don't need it.
Wish it were. The France family in Daytona Beach found it and privately holds the National Association for Stock Car Auto Racing. So you won't find it listed, folks. However, some of the speedways are public corporations. Contact your local broker for information. Here's Ricky Rudd, the defending champion of the Slick 5300 in his tied Ford. Morgan Shepherd is also in, and Bill Elliott in the McDonald's Ford. Watch Bill Engel's team go to work here on Ricky Rudd, and this looks like a two-tire stop.
Yep, looks four-tire. There's a tire man in the bottom.
Yep, down there at the right rear, they're loosening those lug nuts. Four-tire stop. Morgan Shepherd got only two. Bill Elliott will get four. Rudd is away. Chassis change on the right rear of Elliott's car. Hutt Strickland is in, and Darrell Waltrip, the gas mileage king of NASCAR, finally comes in. Lap after everybody else. There's Darrell in the Western Auto Chevy. Told us yesterday, if you missed our telecast, the car wasn't quite right. He wasn't quite sure how he would run today, but he's held on to the lead lap.
Told me, he said, don't worry about how I'm running. I'll be up near the front when it's over. I said, okay, I'm going to keep you to it.
Bobby Hillen is in. So is Jeff Burton, getting right side tires on the Ray Vestas Ford.
Mike, you can see the difference in the car that has tires right now. You see Earnhardt just moving over and letting Rusty Wallace go. Earnhardt will be coming in this time, I'm almost sure.
The pit board is out for Dale Earnhardt. Way down in turn number one. Last pit stall.
I just want to see him run another lap. He moves over like he wants these cars to go on. Dale's off the pace quite a bit right now. He needs to get in the pit.
I'm sure that, you know, they're all hoping for a caution now, because if they have a caution, Dale Earnhardt's going to look like a real smart guy, because, you know, most of the guys are going to be a lap down.
Dick Trickle, the Budmore Ford Quality Care Thunderbird on pit road. And now they're up on top of the wall in the Earnhardt pit, so here he comes. Glenn Jarrett, two tires or four?
Mike, Richard Childers told me this will be four tires, but after I said what I did on race day this morning, I don't know if they'll tell me the truth or not. No, he said it would be a four-tire stop. They're going to make a slight adjustment with air pressure. The car not exactly to Dale's liking, but they've waited as long as they can. They went a long way, in fact, further than anybody has gone so far on this stop. They go to the right side. Nothing unusual going on right now. The left side lug nuts are being loosened, so it will indeed be a four-tire stop. Looks like a good stop. I didn't get a clock on it. I hope somebody did, but this looks like a real good stop. Left side's on it down. 17.3 seconds. Excellent stop by Dale Earnhardt's crew.
Michael Waltrip in the Pennzoil Pontiac and John Andretti in the Kmart Little Caesars Ford become a couple of the final drivers to pit under this round of green flag stops. Wake up! We'll be right back.
Have I been cursed yet?
Not that I know of.
Okay.
Should you be?
Probably.
Okay.
I know the truck has.
No, you have not.
Okay.
Not to I know of.
Not to my knowledge.
18 leading.
Bobby Labonte needs to get in.
Who has not stopped besides him?
Bobby Labonte needs to get
in. He's stopping right now.
Okay. Okay.
He led a lap, though.
See the last car?
Yep.
All Opryland USA is the official destination of NASCAR. For more information, call Monday through Friday, 615-889-6611. Bobby Labonte led a lap, but his Interstate Battery Chevy is now on pit road, getting four tires. And he'll surrender the lead to Mark Martin. Green flag pit stops have been completed. Just about back where we were, with Mark Martin leading Jeff Gordon, Rusty Wallace up to third, and Terry Labonte in fourth. Glenn Jarrett's in Mark Martin's pit.
Steve, you made a little bit of a gamble there to try two tires. Was it because of what Gordon did, or you just wanted to see what your car would do?
Well, Jeff ran real good on his too, and hit the first yellow when we put on four. The lefts were just perfect, so we thought we'd just go ahead and get rides and try to keep from getting lapped or have a little bit of a lead when everybody else pitted. Get us some breathing room and maybe stop a little short the next time if there wasn't a caution. Typically in New Hampshire, there's plenty of caution, so it wasn't really a big gamble.
Does Mark say there's a lot of difference with the way the car feels?
No, he hadn't said a word. He just wanted to know where the leader was before everybody pitted. If we'd been lapped, and I just told him he was the leader, so he's just kind of riding right now.
Well, he definitely knows where the leader is now.
Yes, he does. That's Steve Meehl, who grew up in upstate New York. For 5 years in his late teens and early 20s, he hung out at the L&R Speed Shop in Malta, New York. They ran a wrecker service during the week and sold speed parts and went stock car racing on the weekends. Sad bit of racing history is the L&R Speed Shop. It's torn down this week for further development.
Steve Meehl, one great crew chief. You see Darrell Walsh fixing to go a lap down to Mark Martin, the race leader here. DW said, I don't think so. I'm going to race you just a little bit. He'll pick up the pace. One thing about Darrell, you don't know what he has until somebody puts a little pressure on him.
Well, he heard you were talking about him.
Front straightaway. Martin looks to the inside. No. Nothing there. Now, where's Jeff Gordon?
Right there.
There's the difference in the pit stops. Two tires versus four. There's the second place car. Right behind the number 40 of Rich Bickle, the Kendall Pontiac. And here's the race for sixth place with Derek Culp getting underneath Rick Mast. And here comes Ricky Rudd, last year's winner of this race. 12 straight years, Rudd has won at least one Winston Cup race. Hasn't yet won this year, but last year he hadn't before he came here to New Hampshire.
Well, usually as the racetrack gets slick, he gets better and better because he's one of the best slick track drivers I've ever watched. And don't count him out yet.
He's in the chase late in the day. Rudd will be a contender. 133 laps complete. The race is stabilized after this round of green flag pit stops, so we'll take a quick break and be right back to New Hampshire after this.
Make it lighter. Make some race brighter. Please run side by side somebody. Musgraves and Lake Speed are going at it.
Okay. Okay.
Don't you dare leave this action.
Yeah, we're kind of light on our sold features so far, huh? No good. Dale Earnhardt bumped the 12 and 24. Why didn't he go to the penalty box? Thank you, Rhonda. We'll pass that one down to Mike Helton.
Look at old DW. He's still running ahead.
Okay, Larry, here we go. Larry from Illinois. Why does a car run better on fresh tires?
Has something to do with a rubber compound being cool.
You get to tell everybody. If there are any of those you like, you know, help yourself. Okay. I have it. Thank you.
If I'm not mistaken, does rubber have a petroleum substance to it also? As it heats up, it gets oily?
I don't think it really gets oily, buddy.
You had
tacky.
I got to put you in one of these heavy things.
That's why my race car only weighs 1,500 pounds.
I won't touch on that. It
gets tacky.
What it does,
sticky tacky.
It gets hot and loses traction. Larry from where?
Illinois.
Illinois. I thought he was ill.
No, he's not. Oh.
Just kidding if you're watching.
Well, we're in New Hampshire, and the flags are flying. Quite a variety here. If you see the TNN team going down the road in the new Winnebago from Cedar Ridge Motorhomes, give us a wave and give them a call. Winnebago and Cedar Ridge, the choice of champions. Call 1-800-988-4884 for more information.
Well, that looks exactly like the one you drove up here this week.
Yes, it does. No dents in that one either. Sorry, Joe, just kidding. Just kidding. Ricky Rudd closing it down on Dale Earnhardt. He said Rudd would be a factor in this race, and he is proving it.
Yeah, here he comes. You see how low he runs through the corner. He picks up the throttle. He's an ex-motorcycle racer when he was younger, and most of those guys understand traction. Because, you know, the last thing in a motorcycle you want is the back wheel in front of the front.
Now, also, tell me if this is myth or fact. When a driver comes back to a track where he last won, he's apt to be more competitive.
I think momentum means a lot. It always meant a lot to me. If I could go back to a racetrack that I won at, I felt like, well, maybe I had a little something on everybody is the reason I won here. Then I usually got proved wrong by getting beat. But
Ernie, you agree?
I'm not real sure. I don't think, especially when it's happened, like Ricky Rudd came, it's a year from now. You know, it was a year ago that he won the race here. So I do think some of it has a factor. And also, like our team, I mean, we knew we had a pretty good setup to come here. And we unloaded off the truck and we were pretty competitive. So the racetrack doesn't really change. Race cars doesn't really change. So usually you should be able to come back and run good if you run good the time before.
Well, Rudd's running well. Here's Earnhardt, and here is John Andretti underneath Jimmy Spencer. Makes the pass.
Digging now. Keep digging. Four.
Oh,
four.
Jeremy Mayfield is fun.
Stay low. He's way up high there. Keep coming. Keep coming.
Buddy Barnes telling John Andretti to stay low and
the
run
the yellow
to the flag.
Is out. Yep.
Caution flag. Caution flag. Keep digging now.
You know, if we get any more of these spotter radios, they're not going to need us up here.
Oh, those guys do a great job. I tell you, they get you out of more predicaments. They can see things you can't see from the race car.
I'm kidding, folks. I like it up here.
I tell you, you know, nowadays, spotters are actually having two jobs. There's actually being two spotters. You'll have one spotter that judges what the cars are. Let's take a look at this. Can't really see. Oops.
Looked like Rick Mast might have gotten the back of Jeremy Mayfield, turned him just there coming out of turn four.
And Trickle just saved going into Rick Mast. Jeff Bodine made up his lap. He passed Mark Martin one lap ago, so he is back in the lead lap.
That's why you never give up. You run every lap like it's the last one.
Ernie, you were saying two spotters.
Yeah, see, a lot of times what's happening is you know, you're having one that actually watches ahead and looks at wrecks. You're having one other spotter actually being the eyes in the tower.
Look at this, everybody coming down pit road.
And it hasn't been that long since they were in. About lap 120 for most of the cars, so they've been out there between 20 and 30 laps.
This is where all the bragging rights start.
Now we get to see which is the quickest of these three crews. Top to bottom, Mark Martin, Jeff Gordon, Rusty Wallace, and who will take two, who will get four. Two tires for Gordon again.
Wow, it didn't even look like he hardly stopped.
I thought he gassed and goed.
Did he?
No, he was out pretty quick.
Rusty Wallace down pit road. Earnhardt shoves it in gear, gets the spot. Ricky Rudd, Mark Martin, Terry Labonte, Sterling Marlin, and Morgan Shepherd off pit road. We'll come back and sort out the running order right after this word. We're under caution at New Hampshire.
They have got to do something about this pit road thing. Dale Earnhardt come in way behind. Went right out in second.
We know. Not my favorite rule.
Andy Petrie wanted to kick my butt for saying something about that. So.
Well, hey.
We're not on right
I'm
now.
I'm sorry, Tom.
That's the obvious there. Wow.
I need 10. The lead in is so long, please. But that's all I need. Did Gordon get two tires or did he just get gassed? Anybody?
And I'm not real sure. It was sure fast.
He did get two. Thank you. Thank you, Jeffrey. Well, you would.
Oh, boy.
Your name's not Gordon.
Anybody flies the left like you should have indigestion.
Yeah, the story is on the 24. The car was already tight, is what he said to Ray. You only had 30 laps on those. We might as well just give you a two. Right?
Okay. Earnhardt probably got into the back of Trickle when they all checked up.
Yeah,
you
I
think
saw
so?
That. Yeah, I saw
oh,
that.
The nose is really torn in. Look.
Yes.
Yeah, Earnhardt got into him a little bit.
Yeah, they might have bent something in on the front of the three, Nelson was telling
yep.
me.
Yep, that nose is uglier than his.
Like it's got his tongue out. Look.
Oh.
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by Pep Boys Automotive Supercenter.
Dale Earnhardt in that incident got into the back of Dick Trickle trying to check up and miss the incident. And the nose of his car is a little bit crushed in. Will that hurt it?
Nah, I don't think so.
He'll
I mean,
just make it meaner and a little uglier looking.
Yeah. Remember Earnhardt when he had the whole front end tore off at Bristol?
The good part is you see the screened area there in the front. That's where the air goes back to the radiator, and that looks pretty good.
So we're set to go back to green. Earnhardt, thanks to a quick pit stop by his crew, and that number one pit stall that goes to the champion, is out of the pit second and right behind Jeff Gordon. Rusty Wallace is third. Ricky Rudd is fourth. In fifth, that'd be Mark Martin, who was leading when we came to caution. Sixth is Terry Labonte, and seventh is Sterling Marlin. Green flag at lap 148.
Jeff Gordon got a great start there. Look at Rusty Wallace moving by Earnhardt on the bottom side there. You see Hut Strickland in the green car there. Even though the back end of that car is torn up in a wreck earlier in the race, he's running quite well now.
Three laps down, though, Strickland in number 26. Rudd pulls to his bumper. Earnhardt's car is off.
Okay, moving over here. He knows he's three laps down. You can see him getting out of the way of the lead cars. Oh, we have a big mess here.
Oh. Jeff Bodine, Jeff Burton, Bobby Labonte.
I know I got the fucking toe.
Are three of the cars involved. Don't know whose radio that was. Wouldn't tell you if I did. Todd Bodine comes to the pit lane and Dale Jarrett.
It is
may
a grown
also
up
have been
sport.
Involved in that. We're sorry, folks, but as you well know, tempers flare. Trying to get a lap back is Mike Wallace. It won't happen as Gordon leads them across. As they pull on Todd Bodine's left side. Pretty torn up.
He broke the handout bar on Todd Bodine's car.
And look at Jeff Bodine's. That rear spoiler isn't doing much on the X-side Ford.
And he just got back into the lead lap, too.
Yes. We'll come back and sort it out, folks. 149 laps are complete. We are under caution for the fourth time today. I know who that was.
I do too.
I never recognized it. Who was
I'll write it down for you.
Okay.
Here's my guess.
He said, doggone it.
Do you think? Is he on the list?
75? No.
No? Okay.
I think it was
Bobby Labonte.
Who I think it was.
Is having trouble.
Yeah.
Todd Bodine either broke the trailing arm or something loose in the rear end because the rear end housing was sliding.
Whoever it was, the toe end's messed up.
What caused it?
Yeah, give us an idea down here on pit road what happened up there.
We don't know.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Sorry, guys.
Okay.
We didn't see it.
Oh, yeah. And that's the voice.
That's the voice.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, I got the voice.
Boy, it's just a grown up.
I didn't even see that car was out there. I mean, I didn't even see it was in it.
That's the bad part of listening to these guys.
And it wasn't the spotter.
No, we know who it is.
Yeah.
We knew that. Yes, I am.
Bodine's chances just went up.
Yeah, they did.
37 got a tire rub on the right front.
Have we seen the damage on the nose?
Welcome back to Loudoun, New Hampshire, the New Hampshire International Speedway, and live Winston Cup racing on TNN. The AutoZone Tech Fact is brought to you by the more than 1,000 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, best parts in auto parts.
You know, one of the most familiar faces in the Winston Cup garage area is that of Earl Parker II with Champion spark plugs. Now, if you've ever been at the track and seen the guys practicing, sometimes you'll hear them cut their cars off clean under full power down the back stretch. They bring the car into the garage area, remove the spark plugs, bring them right over to Earl's van. And Earl, what are you looking for when you read these plugs?
Well, basically what we do is we examine the firing end, the end that is actually in the cylinder. We look for coloration and deposits that tell us something about the state of tune of the engine. We look for track factors, weather factors, anything that can affect the state of tune, whether it's too rich, too lean, an oil control problem, ignition energy problem. Any one of about 20 or 25 different things can be spotted.
Why do they cut the car clean under full power down the backstretch?
That basically is like taking a snapshot, a Polaroid, if you will, of what's going on in the combustion chamber at wide open throttle. And that's what you're really interested in. When you drive it into the pits and you chug it in, as we say, the air-fuel mixture is not the same. There's so many things that aren't the same. And it basically destroys the plug reading. It destroys the snapshot.
Well, Earl has been doing this for Champion Plugs for about 8 years now. Before that, the man they came to was Earl Parker, his father.
And the amazing thing, Glenn, he does it all visually. No computers and no instruments. He looks at them and he reads those plugs. Here's your Goodyear mid-race recap brought to you by Goodyear, number one in tires. 6 liters, 9 lead changes, average speed, counting the caution laps down to 108 miles an hour. 4 cautions, and here are the leaders. Mark Martin has dominated today.
You want to see how soft the springs are in this 24 car here. When he was rocking it back and forth there, it raised up some 3 inches on the left front spoiler.
With the hood up, Bobby Labonte, and with the deck lid and rear area all apart, Jeff Bodine. As we get set to go back to green at lap 152, Bobby Labonte came in here ninth in the Winston Cup point standings. Jeff Bodine was 18th. Hold it down and let him go. Jeff Gordon brings him across as Labonte and Bodine rejoin the race. Getting his lap back, perhaps, Bobby Hillen on the inside. He does for now.
He does. Earnhardt. Here comes Earnhardt up on the inside.
For the lead.
For the lead. Rusty will kind of look this over to see which one of these guys. You see him making a move on Gordon on the bottom side. Takes over second place.
Ooh, Ricky Rudd tries to come down, but Rich Bickle is there. Single file. The thing's just a little tense on these restarts for a couple of laps till it sorts out.
Definitely are. Yeah, they're not as tense as they are right after a crash.
But it looks like with the jockeying around out there, because are there times when you feel, well, maybe I can't get them when we're running, but maybe I can just get them on the restart?
Oh, they're definitely, yeah. The man, there sure is. Rusty Wallace and Dale Earnhardt, you know, that's times of the past, you know. Those guys have raced so much together, and now we're seeing it again, and both flat cars and both real good competitors. There goes Rusty. Looks like he's going to get by him this time, I think.
He's going to try, but that three car is a rocket ship down the back straightaway. He didn't quite have enough stuff to make the move. Look at Rusty's car in the center part of this corner, though. He may just give him a little nudge, let him know he's there.
I'm sure he probably will.
Rusty took a second turn of the wheel there, coming out of the corner.
Rusty's car is really getting through the middle of the corner, and that's what really you have to work on all day here at Loudoun, New Hampshire. You know, you got to get through the middle. Everybody has about the same amount of motor and, you know, same amount of forward bite, and, you know, getting into the corner, but getting through the middle, that's the main thing.
Lap 158, though lap 150 is halfway. And now it was not a green lap, so at lap 158, they'll pay the $10,000 bonus.
Wow, he got up under Jeff Bodine and really got him loose coming up out of that corner. That took that's just like lifting the back end up when you get that close on a car. He really got sideways there.
Well, I'm sure Jeff's car's not handling like it was, you know, because he could stay in front of him.
Okay, here we go for $10,000. This time by whoever leads it. Gower and Hart needs $10,000 more. But there's a lot of pride at stake, too. And some points. Ring the bell for 10 grand.
Rusty's not going to let him have it for free.
Won't be jet fuel for Rusty. It'll be
jet fuel for Earnhardt's
pocket. Yeah, right.
He's got a jet, too, yeah.
Rusty doesn't have a jet yet, so that's why he was wanting that $10,000 so he could get him one.
There's an Air Force right there in this film that we're showing you right here. The first four or five cars that are racing right now, everybody's got an airplane. You must have them anymore to get from point A to point B.
Well, and not just to go to the races, but the demand for personal appearances on these drivers is so great and their scheduling is so tight that oftentimes just can't accommodate the commercial airline schedule. It's a matter of convenience rather than a matter of status.
Look at Rusty Wallace. He's making a move on Earnhardt out of turn two and down the back straightaway for the lead.
Now, Jeff Gordon's got it the smart way because Rick Hendricks has airplanes. Jeff doesn't have to have one. There you see Ricky Rudd. You can see him right at the back of the screen. Oh, Rusty got a little loose off of four. Earnhardt's going to go ahead. I wonder how that happened.
Don't care to guess.
Look at Jeff Gordon now. His car runs well after about four or five laps. He didn't have the speed right at first. And Ricky Rudd coming along.
Mark Martin still there.
The 10 car is Ricky Rudd. He's even with Rusty Wallace going into turn three. The 6 car there is Mark Martin. And just behind him, Morgan Shepherd in the 21 car.
The two Chevys took off and they left the four Fords to battle among themselves.
Look at Morgan. Whoa.
Mark got in up high.
Morgan got real racy. Yeah, brothers Ford, Citgo car. In the wall, turn one, Ward Burton. Just caught it with the left front. The car had already done a complete spin, but he went in pretty hard. And the Hardy Chevrolet will bring out the caution. This will be the fifth caution flag. Comes out of lap 162.
Quite a bit of damage, you can see. That's mostly tire smoke.
Ward was 29th in the Winston Cup points. Spun the car, but couldn't keep it off the wall. Didn't really see what started it.
Mike, on a flat racetrack like this, when a race car goes around, it's got nowhere to go but outside.
Yeah, that's for sure.
When it comes around this way, it's got nowhere to go but on the truck, I believe. But we'll see.
It looks pretty bad, especially the left front.
Well, they drove it in, so at least they think they've got a shot to get him back in the race. Tom from Illinois called in on our 800 number, wondered if Bobby Hamilton out of Nashville, Tennessee, any relation to Pete Hamilton, who won the Daytona 500 in 1970? No.
Two different parts of the country.
Pete Hamilton from Dedham, Mass. And Bobby Hamilton from Nashville, Tennessee. Rusty Wallace will pit. Everyone else stays out at lap 163. We'll let you know what they do to that car when we come back to Loudoun. You're watching Winston Cup Racing live on TNN, the Nashville Network.
got cheese and crackers right behind you.
Okay.
Ooh. I've been trying to eat right.
You don't have any.
I've been doing that.
You've been working out too.
Been working out and trying to eat the right stuff.
I hear you work out with our chief whip over there, Pam.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Uh huh.
Nah, she didn't come very often, so.
Oh gee, now see there, Pam. He's telling on you. Yeah, he said you didn't go work out much. Oh. Gosh.
Warren and Jeff Burton have both been on pit road. Welcome back to New Hampshire International Speedway. Mike Joy with Buddy Baker and Ernie Irvin up top. Here's your Ford Buddy Baker race driving tip, brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? It's complete. Overcast skies here at Loudoun, New Hampshire, but temperatures in the mid-70s and a packed house. They're not baking in the grandstand today, and they're not trying to wring out the rainwater either. Let's take a look at the men behind the wall. We'll start this little look with the 16 team of Ted Musgrave, headed up by Jack Roush and Howard Comstock, the crew chief. There are some of the folks that make that car go for driver Ted Musgrave. One of whom Glenn found is a rather interesting story in himself.
Well, he certainly is a really nice guy. This is Bob Ripple, affectionately known as Uncle Fester. Now, Bob has been, he competed against Jack Roush back in their drag racing days, so he's known him a long, long time. You guys have had a heck of a year. Exactly what are your duties on the team, Bob, or should I say Fester?
Well, I'd rather be called Bob. The Fester thing's kind of a joke. Pit crew got the nickname the Adams Family. But I'll tell you what, this pit crew is one of the big reasons that we've been running up front and finishing good. This may be the best pit crew on pit road.
What are your duties?
Pardon?
What are your duties?
On race day, I do the gas mileage.
He's always busy. I see him over here with his calculator, so I can't talk to him all the time. I have to wait till he gets through with his work first. Awfully nice guy. One of the reasons this team has been so successful this year, Ted Musgrave, definitely the most pleasant surprise on the Winston Cup circuit this year, currently in fourth in the points.
Thanks, Glenn. Ted Musgrave running 11th today. Totally nuts for NASCAR, they are. A lot of NASCAR fans here in New England. We'll be right back.
How do you do that? End up exactly on one.
I'm not going to tell.
That's why he gets the big ball.
You don't think I'm going to tell?
They don't even do that well on Good Morning.
Good Morning America.
Oh,
hey,
Debbie Bound sneaking a grape.
If I told, maybe everybody could do it. Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
I think this is about my 12th banana this weekend.
Yeah.
Wow. A potassium kid.
I just keep eating them because we've got them in the truck.
I like them.
You'll be hunting a tree for a long
time. or a tire.
Yeah.
Glenn's got about 11 people following him. Hi, Glenn. No, they're guys.
Glenn, oh. Don't trip.
I won't.
Where are you going, Glenn?
So far, the only problem I have with people tripping around here is they trip over my big feet. There's a big, big battle, brouhaha, if you will, brewing between Earnhardt and Wallace. They're talking back and forth.
No doubt about that. Robin had a few choice words for the driver of the three, and Rusty is really...
He's not
as unhappy as he fences Talladega.
Yeah, and also Jeff Gordon has told Ray Evernham, he says, hey, let's just back up and let these two idiots settle. He said they are doing crazy things.
I won't vote you on that.
It looked too crazy to me.
Welcome back to TNN's live coverage of the Slick 5300 here in Loudoun, New Hampshire. We're under caution. This is the fifth one of the day for Ward Burton's crash up at turn number one. With today's Peerless Faucets Innovation in Motion, here's Larry McReynolds. Peerless, get more out of your faucet than just water.
On a Winston Cup race car, this track bar or panhard bar is a very valuable adjustment tools that teams use to adjust the handling on their race car. Up till about the middle of last year, teams really only used this tool during practice because it involved pulling a boat out, moving the track bar, putting a boat back in. You can raise this track bar and actually loosen the race car up, make it turn a little better. You can lower it and actually tighten the car up, tie the rear end of the car down. About the middle of last year, teams put this adjustment bolt in here and adjust it just as we adjust wedge on a pit stop. So now on a pit stop, you might see a crew member run this half-inch drive ratchet down in this hole, and they'll go this way if they want to tighten the car up. They may back it off if they want to try to loosen the car up. This is just another adjustment tool that Winston Cup teams have learned to use on pit stops to make their performance even better.
And there's Larry McReynolds at work. Yesterday he was the weatherman on our Saturday telecast.
Well said by a man that ought to know.
Yes, one of racing's top crew chiefs.
He watches the Weather Channel more than baseball.
And well, he tapes it. He watches the reruns too.
Yeah.
Did you hear what Mike called him? Larry McReynolds.
Well, he was yesterday. Let's go back to racing. The front five without Rusty Wallace, who made a pit stop under that caution period. And Wallace will restart 19th.
Maybe Rusty had to pit and cool down or something.
Well, it does get him away from Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon, who've been battling pretty hard.
Yeah.
I don't think that's why he stopped.
I don't either.
Here's Gordon for the lead. I'm in there, I'm out of there. Randy, why did Rusty pit?
Well, I wouldn't call it severe left front damage, but he definitely had some damage. It could have caused the tire rub. They had to come in and change the tires. Whether he got it from making contact with Earnhardt or some other car, it came from that incident when he lost the lead.
Thanks, Randy. Oh, a lot of tension on these restarts.
Well, Burton put down a little bit of oil in his oil dry on this racetrack. You can see Earnhardt go sideways in the middle of turn three. There's quite a row of, you probably see it right there on the outside. You can see the oil dry through that corner. Pretty slick through there.
Earnhardt's car is really getting through the middle there pretty good, too.
It's a lot better than it was on the last restart.
Right.
Ricky Rudd in third, Chevy Ford.
And Jeff didn't go good on the last restart, so... maybe he stays in the lead for four or five laps and he's going to be able to be all right.
Three wide back straight away behind the leaders as they work past Elton Sawyer. There's that mess.
Wow.
Boy, Sterling Marlin made the big move and got underneath Terry Labonte and Sawyer, whose Hooters Ford has run up the racetrack.
That was a smart move on everybody's part there to kind of give way a little bit, because there was some oil dry on the outside. Look at Ricky Rudd. He gets by Dale Earnhardt now. Moves into second place.
I hated to pick him to win 2 years in a row and be right 2 years in a row.
Oh, wait a minute. No, you can't do that.
I can't hedge my bet?
No, no.
Okay.
Where you start in the canoe, you finish in the canoe.
Well, my canoe sprung a leak, so I want another pick. 172 of 300 laps. Jeff Gordon the leader. Ricky Rudd in second. Dale Earnhardt in third. Chevy Ford, Chevy. In fourth, Morgan Shepherd's Ford. Fifth, the Ford of Mark Martin. In sixth, the Ford of Derek Cope. And seventh, the Chevrolet of Sterling Marlin. There's that battle. From fifth place, Mark Martin, you're looking ahead at Morgan Shepherd of the Citgo Ford of the Wood Brothers.
Car looks awful stable off the corner there. Morgan Shepherd looks really good. He's right up front. He's run a good conservative race all day today.
Just three cars ahead of them. I want to give a call to Todd Bodine in the Lowe's Ford. What an awful week. They went out to qualify, and Todd said the car just wouldn't run. And Brett Bodine. And Brett said the car just wouldn't pull. And it turned out the throttle wasn't opening all the way. Then they go out to run second round qualifying, and he says the car just, something's holding it back. There wasn't any grease in the transmission, they found. I mean, just small things, but he ended up with a provisional start, and he's a lap down, but he is the first car one lap down in 23rd spot.
I was just watching Ricky Craven had to make him stop and go just then. I don't know why, but I think you know.
Ricky Craven pitted early, but then didn't restart at the end of the longest line. He must have pitted with the lead lap cars. Craven is two laps down. So he will get a stop and go. And the winner of yesterday's Auto Palace 150. We'll backslide a bit in the field. Up front, Ricky Rudd puts the pressure on Jeff Gordon. Let's go down to Dale Earnhardt's pit and find out why Earnhardt has not been challenging Gordon for the lead off this restart.
Standing by with Andy Petrie. Andy, we see some nose damage on the car. First of all, what happened, and is it affecting the way the car's driving now?
No, I don't think so. I don't think it hurt us any. It's closed up a little bit of the air opening we've got, but we had too much to start with, so that didn't really hurt.
All right, is the car pretty much his liking? You told me this morning you thought you were really good. I know you've adjusted a little on it.
Today has really been a long run. We haven't been that good right off the bat on a short run, so I didn't expect we could stay up front right there. He'll stay in rhythm here. I think he can catch him back.
Well, if anybody can keep it in rhythm, that man can.
There's Earnhardt, three car lengths back of Ricky Rudd. And Jeff Gordon, the leader. In the point standings, they are 9 points apart. Morgan Shepherd, perennial top 5 point finisher, 10th in the points coming into this race.
Morgan Shepherd moved into fourth place, and just behind him, your early race leader, Mark Martin, is following him around. Morgan Shepherd is really running well today.
No surprise, he's a good slick track driver as well.
Indeed. You go to Martinsville, that's one of the cars you always have to worry about. He really knows how to get on that throttle and not break the car loose.
I'll tell you what, Morgan is one of the guys that just seems to always finish in the top 10 in points. You know, he's there every day. He very seldom wrecks. He's real consistent. You know, I mean, Morgan's not a young whippersnapper. He's been here for a long time and a lot of experience.
That's what Darrell Waltrip said yesterday. He has a bunch of experience.
Experience.
53 years old, Morgan Shepherd. 179 laps. Jeff Gordon, who is but 23 years old, continues to hold sway here at New Hampshire. We'll be right back. Yeah.
30 years difference. Wow. Well, I wish you'd asked Andy what the problem was with him and Rusty.
He asked me before I started, so what are we going to talk about? I said, well, I wonder what's going on. He said, I don't know and don't ask him. Well, boy, it's pretty loud out here.
Hey.
Yeah.
We can listen to MRN.
Oh, let's not do that. What, Pam? Okay.
Ricky Rudd got the only inch and a half low snout in the place.
Oh, he got a different snout on the car.
Yeah.
And an eighth of an inch more rear spoiler, and looked like the Ford's problems are over.
I don't see a whole lot of them up there. Maybe sniffing from fourth on
I
back.
I think the only way that the Fords are going to get equal is to take about another inch and a half of spoiler off the 24 car.
Oh.
Let's see, 21, 6, 12. Number two, and. They represented.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty good. I mean, it's the 20.
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by Splitfire, the patented performance spark plug. It only costs more till you use it.
NASCAR fans can make cruise history by cruising from Cape Canaveral to the Bahamas December 4 to 7 on the Big Red Boat. TNN and the Winston Cup Racing Wives Auxiliary will welcome Winston Cup drivers, including Kyle Petty, Todd Bodine, Ted Musgrave, Steve Grissom, and that old sea salt, Ernie Irvin. And the proceeds will benefit the Winston Cup Drivers' Wives Auxiliary. That'll be Ernie, who will be skiing off the back of the boat. Call 1-800-972-2359 for more information. He cruised with Buddy and I and Rusty Wallace 1 year, and there's places we can't go back to.
Well, yeah. Carlos and Charlie's, I think it was.
Yeah, I think it was.
Yeah.
In Cozumel. Yeah.
I hit my head real hard, but I remember a lot of that stuff.
We have videotape.
Oh.
We got up the next morning, and here's this tape in Ernie's camera, and it was the whole party, and we're all watching it. Nobody knew who shot it until we realized you were the only guy that weren't in it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah, I think we had another problem.
We had several. We weren't handling too well, folks.
Yeah.
Here's Rusty Wallace, who restarted 19th, and now he's challenging Joe Nemechek for 12. Hey, those cruises are a lot of fun, folks. They trail the leaders by 9.8 seconds. Rick Mast right in the middle of that battle. And Sterling Marlin, the Winston Cup point leader, right back in the chase. He's in seventh place, just ahead of Terry Labonte.
You know, he wasn't running all that good at the beginning of the race. I mean, you know, he was getting past and, you know, just wasn't all that well. Now they must have made some adjustments, and Sterling's car's really good.
Mike, you want to know why this car really works as well as it does? Watch the back window down the straightaway. It's got a tremendous amount of down pressure on it.
Yes, it does, buddy.
I don't think that's what we're supposed to notice, buddy.
Oh, well. Hood's moved. Back window's moved. Driver's moved. They're going.
You know, going on that big red boat, that's going to be a fun thing for the kids. That's what it's mainly all about.
Well, everybody behaves like kids on those courses.
Well, that's for sure.
Yeah.
You know, it's basically we're going to take our families and do some autographs and some other things, and it's going to be a lot of fun.
Should be. 111 laps to go here at Loudon, New Hampshire. Our Goodyear in-car camera showing you these pictures from Sterling Marlin's Kodak Chevrolet.
I heard Tony Glover say 30-90, I think. So
that's 30.90 seconds the last lap.
Right. And the pole this today was like a 29.54, I think. That was Mark Martin. So, you know, about a second and a half slower right now.
Had two great races here yesterday. Had some 800 calls about those in the Auto Palace 150 for Busch Grand Nationals. Was won by Ricky Craven, took the lead from Kelly Moore with just a couple of laps to go. And in the 40-lap modified shootout, what a thriller. Stephen Park beating Tony Hirschman and Jan Leedy in that 40 green flag lap shootout. Here's your Napa field standing update. Napa, we keep America running. Here's how they're running. 190 laps on the board.
You know that window is caving in pretty good, isn't it, buddy?
I didn't notice that time.
Yeah, we don't. And here comes the 33 car.
Yeah. Oh, did you see the 33 car? One of his flaps come up on his on the cowl deal.
A little difference in air pressure suddenly there when he got right into the draft of Sterling Marlin. See if you see that again. Oh, there it is, just fluttering a little bit. Right cowl flap. Just to the base of the windshield.
You can notice a lot of stuff up there.
Look at that crowd. You talk about race fans. Now, these people up here, they get a good dose of it from one of the greatest hidden treasures they have in New England. That's the modified division right here. Oh, that's wonderful.
Was that a great race? Jan Leedy bump drafting Steve Park all down the back straightaway, not once but several times, trying to get away from the field. What a great show.
It is a great race.
And you will see that race played on TNN. Watch your local listings because we will have a couple of replays for the modified shootout and the Busch Grand National race that was rain delayed. We didn't get to show you the finish live because it was nearly dark by the time we got that in yesterday late afternoon. But it will be on TNN. Be sure to catch it if you can.
I think it was the Busch Grand National North.
Yes, it's Houston. Yep. Quite a good show.
That's Ted Musgrave there in the blue car, just following Robert Presley, number 33 car. They've run very well all day today, just hadn't got to the front where they could really make a charge.
To answer Wally's question from Canada, Ted Musgrave is looking for his first Winston Cup win. He has not yet been to victory lane. He's been close, and he's got quite a string of top five finishes and sits fourth in the points, as Glenn told you.
Kyle Petty just retired his car, it looks like.
Coors Light Pontiac to the garage. Let's visit with Buddy Barnes up on the roof to our right. There in the box is John Andretti's car, that purple and orange 37. And you see in the main picture, Buddy looking down in turn one where his car is. And now he shifts his gaze, looking ahead to the next corner where John is headed, trying to stay one jump ahead of what the driver's able to see.
See, they only have one spotter up there right now. And a lot of teams are starting to get two spotters, you know, like I was saying. So that way, he actually just goes about when cars are trying to pass or you're trying to pass, telling you clear or if somebody's under you. But Buddy basically is trying to also watch ahead, make sure we're about wrecks.
Now that's just to our right. Now he's watching his own car closely because of the proximity there to Bobby Hamilton and that pack of cars he's coming up on. So rather than looking way ahead down the racetrack, he's keeping track of that battle, trying to pick out a lane for John to go to, high or low, that will be to advantage. We'll get back with Buddy in a bit here. 197 laps complete, coming up on 100 to go. Jeff Gordon continues to lead Ricky Rudd, Dale Earnhardt, Morgan Shepherd, and Mark Martin.
Great.
Oh, I like that. Okay. Sure.
If they show it again, buddy, that car is just classic. They run some real soft rear springs and then run that rear sway bar. See, look at that thing.
Yep.
It's like dragging the ground.
Yeah. Thank you.
Earnhardt was doing the same thing.
Hey, Rusty's coming too. Is Rusty getting on the leader? Can we do a watch thing?
You can't believe how soft that car was. When he was the wheel back and forth while ago, it come up that far.
Wow.
You know, rocking.
I was down kind of snooping at it yesterday. Ray Abraham tried. He said, "Man, don't be looking at my car."
You told him it was for TV.
I told him it's because I want to figure out why it goes so fast. Because I know that Jeff just didn't all of a sudden learn how to drive.
Where are my notes here from yesterday about this stuff? Where are my notes from yesterday about that Opryland thing that I left right here? My notes from yesterday.
If you can just show the leader, Morgan Shepherd run him down almost a half a lap. You see how?
Welcome back to Loudoun, New Hampshire. August 24th through September 4th is the TNN Salute to Motorsports. TNN gives you more live racing than any other network. You'll see lots of great examples of it. Driver appearances, show cars, and a lot of neat stuff like the new Brickyard Pace truck. First time a pickup truck has paced a NASCAR race in our recollection. And a lot of new neat displays from the manufacturers, the sponsors, and the race teams. It's all part of what's going on at Opryland this summer. For more information, you can call Monday through Friday, 615-889-6611. You'll see drivers throughout the theme park and exhibits and appearances and merchandise trailers and everything. The TNN Salute to Motorsports, August 24th through September 4th at Opryland. Jeff Gordon is the race leader. Rusty Wallace made a pit stop during that last caution, and he's gaining about 2/10 of a lap on Jeff Gordon, who is trying to move away from the whole rest of the field. Let's go to his pit.
Well, Ray Evernham sitting here watching his driver. Is he just cruising right now, Ray?
Well, he's running as smooth as he can without using the car up. You know, when you try and go faster, sometimes you go slower. So he's just being real careful. There's a long way to go, and we just hope we don't need any more caution. So we're just going to wait and see what happens.
Can you make the car any better at all for him?
He hasn't said anything. As we get closer to a pit stop, right now we're the same as everybody else. We're a little bit tight in the middle, a little bit loose off.
Okay, yeah, probably so. Okay, Glenn.
Well, I'm in Ricky Rudd's pit, and before the race this morning, Billy Engel told me that they were guessing that they were pretty much going to put the car like it was last year when they won. Have you had to change it much, Billy?
Well, we've changed a little bit, Glenn, not too drastic of a change. Tide Ford seems to be working pretty good right now. We just don't have anything at all for that 24. That thing has got some awesome traction up off the corner, and a Randy Dorton motor is pulling it pretty hard.
Is there anything else that you can do to the car?
Yeah, but I'd rather not talk about it right now.
Well, you know, they won here last year, and that's always plenty of incentive to come back and do well. But if you want to see the real incentive that this crew has, it's this picture of Ricky Rudd right here. That's 20 years ago. I'm sure glad he found his way to a barber.
Yeah, that's out of the one of the racing papers this week. My gosh. Let's watch Ricky's car closely and just see as he gets through the middle of the corner how much the body moves over the tires. Not very much on Rudd's car. Big market difference when we show you Jeff Gordon's car here in a minute. Right now, Bill Elliott battles John Andretti and Joe Nemechek, 13th place. Right here, Nemechek holds that position behind Rick Mast. Nemechek at the Burger King 87. Well, I said on race day this morning, I predicted a burger battle. I didn't know it'd be for 13th spot, but that's how it is right now.
You see Bobby Hamilton there making a move on Andretti.
And there's where some of the contenders are, behind Jeff Gordon.
I think the fastest car on the racetrack is being overlooked right now. Morgan Shepherd is really getting around this racetrack. We'll get to him after we watch this battle right now between Hamilton and Andretti off the corner.
I think Shepard's one of them. I think Rusty Wallace is the other.
Yeah, definitely. Rusty's running real good, too.
Here's Shepard trying to get past Ricky Craven. Remember, Craven is five laps down in the Kodiak Chevy after winning here yesterday.
Now, you look at the back of Morgan's car, you know, it transfers some weight, but when we see Jeff Gordon's car, you're going to see that it looks like it's popping a wheelie going down the straightaway.
Looks like one of the Gap and Roush drag cars from the 60s.
Yeah, there it is.
All right, so there's Morgan Shepherd, who currently runs in fourth place. And here's Rusty Wallace moving on up. He's in 10th place right behind Ted Musgrave. Make that 11th place behind Musgrave and Robert Presley. These cars trail the leader by 12 and a half seconds.
That's pretty impressive right there. He has worked his way from the tail end of this bunch all the way up to the 10th place now. And it looks like that car is really hooked up for Rusty. He'll be back up there to visit his dear friend, Mr. Earnhardt, before too long.
If they could only see the smirk on your face when you say that. They got a little close earlier, folks. 210 laps complete. Jeff Gordon leads Ricky Rudd, Dale Earnhardt, Morgan Shepherd. In fifth, Mark Martin. In sixth is Derek Cope. And seventh, Terry Labonte.
Well, now we're going to look at Jeff's car again.
Okay. Gary, what we'd like to see from Jeff's car is the weight transfer when he gets on the throttle, how that car squats in the back. No, not poops, just squats.
Oh.
We just want to see Gordon right close so we can look at the weight transfer front to back.
I mean, as soon as he gets straight, you know, all of a sudden it just goes.
Yeah, when he comes out of two, is
especially off that left rear.
Yep.
Look at the left front hat jacked up in the air.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You know what that car looks like?
Cool.
Looks like Rick Petty's car used to work when he won all the races.
Now watch this, buddy.
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by Midas, the Midas way, the way it should be.
At Loudoun, New Hampshire, Jeff Gordon has a 2.5-second lead, or rather a 3.2-second lead. Dale Earnhardt's moved into second from Dave Marcus's car. Ricky Rudd now third. Now we'll show you what we were talking about with Jeff Gordon and the weight transfer on that car front to back.
Okay, we're going to have to really look at it off of turn two, but you can really see the thing actually come off the corner and it like has a lot of weight transfer to the rear end. the back end goes down. Well, when that's happening, usually, you know, the spoiler goes down and stuff, but let's watch it off of turn two.
Look at the gap in the left front fender between the top of the tire.
Mike, the whole car is really soft. You can see the car down the straightaway just kind of transferring weight evenly front to rear. I mean, it's really sprung light. But these boys will try things, and it's a young team, and they don't act like you know everything. So they work together, and they really make this race car good.
There is a school of thought that says soft springs and stiff sway bars at both ends. One way to get around a flat racetrack.
Well, I tell you, you know, those are one of the guys that are, you know, NASCAR legalized a rear sway bar now. As of last year, and these are one of the guys that actually run it a lot. They run it almost every time. You know, like with our 28 car, we haven't really been able to make it work. And you know, this kind of tells us a little bit, maybe, you know, different ways you have to do things, you know, with the rear sway bar.
Here's the running order. Top five with Earnhardt having moved into second. Let's check that. Ricky Rudd is the third place car, then Morgan Shepherd and Mark Martin. Here's Rusty Wallace, shown in ninth, where he has passed Ted Musgrave and tries to pull down on Sterling Marlin. 84 laps to go. Here's the interval from first back to second. It's 4.3 seconds. Ricky Rudd in third, just behind. Earnhardt got that bloodied nose on his black Chevrolet when he got into the back of Dick Trickle after the car in front of Trickle spun somebody around. Jeremy Mayfield.
Jeremy Mayfield spun.
Bill Elliott battles Bobby Hamilton. Elton Sawyer lapped down and John Andretti.
See Michael Waltrip in the 30 car there, right at the back of those four cars, five cars rather.
Waltrip moves up and under Sawyer, who's running full time on both the Busch and Winston Cup circuits in the second half of this year. His Ford Credit Ford. We got a lot of race fans in Connecticut. Folks tend to discount Connecticut. It's so small and so away from the South as a racing state. But I bet you Wednesday afternoon at Monaco Ford in Glastonbury, we'll have a couple thousand people there. See the race cars and visit with Elton. Now here's Michael underneath, getting past the Hooters Ford. Okay, a couple hundred people. Dale Earnhardt created his own traffic jam here night before last. Our producer, Pam Miller, got into what she said was one of her worst fears. She got into the line of traffic for an Earnhardt appearance. It was almost like trying to leave the racetrack. The cars parked everywhere, nine lines of traffic, all trying to get into this one dealership where Dale was signing autographs for 2 hours here in Laconia.
Man, I mean, he draws the people, you know.
You bet.
He's a seven-time champion, and you know, he's earned all that respect. And
boy, now the speed plug.
He's not
starting the gain on some guys ahead of you. Just follow Rusty up there and catch him. You can do it.
He's not one of the guys that, you know, you don't very seldom see him. You know,
nope.
I live in the same town he does, and you know, kind of Mooresville. I'm there all the time. We never see Dale Earnhardt going to lunch or something like that. He stays at his farm.
I see him all the time. He comes up behind me and gives me a good rap from behind.
On the street.
In your street car, yeah.
Oh, yeah. I told him, I said, this isn't a rental car, you know. He said, I got plenty of them right up the road.
Yeah, he'll sell you one.
3090.
See, Sterling's still running the 3090.
All right, now both you guys, tell me something. Do you like having a spotter or a crew chief? Who's a coach like that, an attaboy, you can do it kind of guy, or would you rather just get the facts and work on it yourself?
Mike, I tell you the honest truth. When you have a guy pulling for you like that, that was Tony Glover, his crew chief, talking to him and getting him into the game a little bit. You know, every once in a while, you kind of relax in these race cars. That was to perk him up and get him going again. You know, every good football team has people that make them really get up. You know, they have a pep rally.
Bill Elliott on pit road. Here's Glenn.
Mike, a little bit of a disappointing day for these guys. They started fourth, their best qualifying effort of the year. They really thought they were going to have something today, but they've missed the handle just a little bit. This car was completely reworked by Mike Beam when he went back to work for Bill Elliott. This is a four-tire change. Good pit stop by the guys. He's down and away. They did make some adjustments to try to get Bill around the track a little bit better, but they're not satisfied so far with the way things have gone.
So Elliott comes back on track at lap 223 for the green flag pit stop. 77 laps to go. Jeff Gordon currently leads Dale Earnhardt, Ricky Rudd, Morgan Shepherd, and pole sitter Mark Martin. That was real good. Okay.
It does make a difference, you know, when they start pepping you up a little bit.
Yeah, you see, now, I'm one of the guys that just tell me you need to tell me. That's it.
Well, I want to get back to that when we come back. Because everybody wants something a little different.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah,
Glover, he was over there. He was trying to pump Sterling up.
Yeah.
Usually you have to tell me that. Now you need to take it a little easy.
Did he talk to you that way?
But no.
No, he
never did.
Ernie, don't tear it up. Slow down.
Yeah, please. Man, don't hit them.
Okay, we'll meet you at the car when the race is over.
Yep.
We'll be with you, pal.
Yep.
Go ahead and do what you got to do. That's what my crew used to say. Whoa.
Oops.
That was Ernie getting ear room on his headset.
Mm-hmm. Mark Martin on the pits. Derek Cope.
Boy, I tell you, Gary's just quit talking to me anymore.
Who?
Gary in the truck. Mm-hmm. You ever heard him getting the cameras to everywhere they got to go?
Man. Yeah.
Pick up the 33. Pick up the 44. Pick up the 13.
Yeah. Okay.
What happened?
He stopped.
Oh.
Welcome back to Loudoun, New Hampshire. 228 laps on the board. Green flag pit stops. Joe Nemechek coming in. You're riding there with Mark Martin, Glenn Jarrett. You cover both those stops.
Well, Mark Martin already made his pit stop. Mike Nemechek's in now. They were discussing a two-tire change, but they are loosening the lug nuts. They are going to make a four-tire change. Mark Martin had four tires, fuel, and took two rounds of wedge out. There's a nice cloud cover now. It's real pleasant out here, but things have cooled off, and a lot of the cars seem to be getting a little bit tight. Nemechek is down with his four-tire change, and he's away.
20-second stop for Joe Nemechek. Rick Mast is in with his Cole Ford and the Morgan McClure Kodak Chevy. Sterling Marlin, the point leader, has made his pit stop. So we're in the pit stop window. Bobby Hillen is in. As you ride with Mark Martin in the Valvoline Ford.
Yeah, our camera's shaking just a little bit right near the end of the straightaway there. Looks like he might have a tire jerking just a little bit.
Earnhardt on pit road. The seven-time champion, third place in the points. Obeying the NASCAR enforced speed limit. Down the pit lane, here's Glenn.
Well, you know, to Earnhardt, Mike, that must seem like the longest pit road on earth, but he's always got the number one pit stop down here. Their car seems to work better the longer they go in the run. You see he got back by Ricky Rudd to take over second. The track seems to come to him a little bit. They are making a slight adjustment with the air pressure on the tire, on the car this time. You see the caved in nose on the car, but he said it does not hurt it. We got an 18.6 second pit stop. That's awfully good work under pressure.
Bobby Labonte is in, the Interstate Battery Chevy, one lap down. And Hut Strickland is in. Ted Musgrave just got four tires in the Family Channel Ford.
See Rusty Wallace go by Earnhardt as he's coming out of the pits there. He's come all the two car of Rusty Wallace has come all the way back to fifth spot already. Fourth now.
Morgan Shepherd on pit road.
Earnhardt back on pit road.
Yes. Let's first go to Randy in the Wood Brothers pit.
I'll tell you, this is a cool bunch down here. I was talking with Eddie Wood. What are you going to do? I don't know. He was holding his fingers up. Two tires, four tires, two tires, four tires. Didn't know what to do. They've gone ahead and made the decision. They're going to go with two right side tires. Morgan Shepherd speed fills the car with gas. Morgan gone. Glenn Jarrett.
Earnhardt has come back in. The reason that pit stop was so fast, they did not get the lug nuts tight all the way around on the right rear tire. He had to come back in, snug him up. That's a costly mistake.
Earnhardt lost a lap to the leader on the stop as Rusty Wallace is in the Miller Genuine Draft Ford. At least right side tires. He's well out from the pit wall. There goes the man with the left side lug nuts. That's a good indication it'll be a four-tire stop. Elton Sawyer's in. The leader, Jeff Gordon, comes down pit road. So does Kenny Schrader. Green flag pit stops at lap 234. There's the stop for Jeff Gordon. Wipe of the windshield as well as four tires. No chassis change apparent.
Yeah, they're very pleased with everything. 16.9.
Ricky Rudd is in the Tide Ford. Terry Labonte, the Kellogg Chevrolet. Mike Wallace, the Heilig Myers Ford. Dale Jarrett's in. And your leader. We're told unofficially, John Andretti has picked up the front spot as he has not yet stopped. Bloody Red Dog Barnes wearing our spotter cam today. Andretti is the race leader at lap 235. John Andretti, nephew of Mario, cousin of Mike.
You are the leader, John. Keep digging, man. You got to get all you can out of these worn out tires. Keep digging.
That pretty much says it. Keep digging.
But now watch how Musgrave will blast by him because Musgrave's on fresh tires. Folks, you want to see the difference between worn tires and new ones? Watch this 16 car.
Hey, well, we're going to put right side tires on that thing right now. Go out 2 pounds with that right rear air pressure. Bring it on in here this time. Two tires and fuel, John. Get it in close to the wall.
That's Tim Brewer talking there. That's crew chief.
And again, like you're saying, keep it in close to the wall so the fellas don't have to come so far around to change the right sides because we're not going to do lefts.
Mike, that's exactly what you were talking about. You see right there, even though Andretti's coming in the pits, he's much slower coming around through that corner.
You're going to be the only one on pit road now. Only one on pit road.
So John Andretti will surrender the lead. Kmart Little Caesars.
Get on in here.
Did you hear what he had said? He said, fudge all you can.
Did he mean the speed limit?
No.
I think he was talking about pudding. Fudge.
Yeah. Jeff Bodine is also on pit road.
I got to go now. Fudge all you can. Fudge all you can.
Good thing we only provide the officials booth with pictures, not
right.
Sound.
Down there, haul ass. Haul ass now.
That means pick up the pace.
We know what that means.
Ooh.
Not much question about that call. Okay. Michael Walter picks up the lead.
I hope
he and his brother Darrell are running 1-2. Pennzoil Pontiac and the Western Auto Chevy have not yet made pit stops.
This will be interesting if caution come out right now.
Oh, yeah.
Whole new shape for the Pontiac Grand Prix. Ken Miller from Pontiac told me yesterday the Street Grand Prix is better in the wind tunnel than these race cars are now. Wow. If that's the case, it'll be a whole nother jumble of spoiler heights and angles and ride heights come 1996. 239 laps complete. And we're up on Waltrip's Mountain. The Waltrip brothers are leading here at New Hampshire International Speedway. We'll be right back.
I couldn't help but say pick the face up.
Thank you.
Not much anybody can do with them, I don't believe, at the moment. I think with a caution, it looks like maybe Rusty could do something with him if he could ever get to him, but I don't know.
Hey, do you think the 21's got anything for Jeff?
Oh, man, no way.
Okay, all right. You know. Okay.
Well, I mean, he might, but they don't think so, you know.
I mean,
he could, but they're not even thinking that.
Yeah. Well, he's running second right now.
Oh, yeah. He's having a great run, but I don't think they're thinking that.
All right.
Watch monitor. Monitor.
Ooh. Mike Wallace got a little help there from Bodine, huh?
Only a little.
Ooh, look at this. Nemechek almost got the right rear corner of that torn up other part.
Not much.
It's
left.
A whole other country.
Not much left there to hit.
Uh-huh.
Michael better stop or he's going to be a lap down when he comes out.
Yeah, that's the bad part. He's leading, but he's losing some more ground.
Michael's car really transfers a lot, too. I'll have to ask him what springs he's got.
Oh, he'll tell you, I'm sure.
Yeah, he will. He will.
Coils.
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by the more than 1,000 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts.
Packed house here at New Hampshire. All those t-shirts in the grandstand, every one with the logo of a favorite driver on it. Let's show you what just happened a couple of laps ago between Mike Wallace, Joe Nemechek, and Jeff Bodine.
See Jeff Bodine there in the 7 car on the bottom side, Mike Wallace on the outside. A little contact there coming through the corner. That's as close to a wreck as you'll ever watch. Great driving by Mike Wallace to get that back straight.
And the battle rages on. Jimmy Spencer battling Rick Mast. And this is for 13th position. These cars are one lap down.
Pretty easy in going in there. I think Spencer realizes there's still a lot of racing to go here. He just backed out and let him have it.
I look at some of the pit stop times, and Dale Earnhardt is back on pit road.
Wow.
Looks like they must have a problem with them lug nuts again or something.
And of course, the speed limit down pit road is enforced under both green and caution flag periods, so Earnhardt will lose another lap. Right side tires.
You know the bad part, Sterling Marlin's still out there. He's only running ninth place right now, but Earnhardt's having trouble, and this points thing is going on, and Jeff Gordon is gaining every race on the lead.
Earnhardt is going to be out of the top 20 when he comes back up to speed. Michael Waltrip continues to lead. Jeff Gordon has moved into second place ahead of Darrell Waltrip. Morgan Shepherd in fourth. Mark Martin, the pole sitter, in fifth. Terry Labonte in sixth. And Derek Cope running in the second spot. Whoever leads the points following this race, which is the designated halfway point in the series, will take home an extra $50,000 in spending money from the folks at Gatorade. In addition to that $10,000 to the leader of the halfway lap.
Mike, we have a report that Earnhardt had a vibration in the car, and that's usually lug nuts loose and wheels are vibrating around on the car.
Darrell Waltrip has made his pit stop, surrenders third place. Michael Waltrip remains the race leader in Chuck Ryder's Pennzoil Pontiac.
I tell you, you know, Gatorade's really stepped up to plate with a lot of different incentives, and we led the halfway point in the truck series and got $10,000 for that. So
great.
It's amazing how much money they're starting to spend and where they're seeing the advertising.
Here's Rusty Wallace down to the inside of Terry Labonte. Sixth place for Rusty.
We're watching a race there for sixth place, but I tell you, the two car of Rusty Wallace right now may be the only car that's running with Jeff Gordon on the racetrack as far as speed.
Check and see when Michael Waltrip was last in the pits. It was in that last round of pit stops, lap 126. He was in under green, and then lap 163, everybody pitted under caution. So they are really stretching it. Doug Hewitt must be hoping for a caution to leave him out that long on worn tires when everyone else has got fresh ones.
There's no doubt that they're searching for a caution, and that way they can get even with everybody else.
Glenn Jarrett has more on the Dale Earnhardt story. He has now dropped to two laps down, Glenn, 26th position.
Well, Mike, this is the right rear tire that they just took off of Earnhardt's car. Buddy Baker, you're exactly right. You can see the lug stud holes here were wallowed out. That's exactly what was wrong. The lug nuts were left loose. He came up to speed and just wallowed out. The vibration got so bad, Dale had to come in and pit it. But you're exactly right, buddy. Loose lug nuts caused this problem.
Looks like they probably should have changed the tire and wheel when they the first time, because they
ran on it
for a while, and now it may have tightened up and didn't actually get into the angled part of the nut.
Mike, you see Michael Waltrip coming down pit road. Look how much brake he's using on the front there. Those wheels are matching. They're yellow. Look, it looked like a black wheel and a yellow wheel. That's how much brake dust is coming out on that car.
Performance Friction carbon metallic pads on all the Winston Cup cars. Steel rotors, of course, 11.3 seconds for just two tires. But the question is, where will Waltrip come back on the racetrack since everyone else has been going these last 10 or 15 laps on fresh rubber?
I have to believe that some of the Winston Cup cars are running the Ray Bestis brake pad now, too.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Mike, he's almost a lap down to Jeff Gordon. Staying out there on those worn tires, it's nice to lead a race, but he lost a lot of position there running old tires when everybody else had come in and got four.
So Jeff Gordon gets back into the lead. Morgan Shepherd's now the second place car. The pole sitter, Mark Martin, has moved up to third.
Would be nice.
Yeah, could you get one?
Yeah, would you walk out on the track, Randy?
No problem. Randy.
Yeah, man.
Randy, hear me now?
Yeah.
What about your head?
Yeah.
My head.
Oh, I wonder what happened to you. Are you trying to get a job up here, trying to hurt your head?
Man, I did. I drilled it.
I've been accused of losing my mind, but not hitting my head.
Yeah.
Not yet.
I heard that from somebody down in the Texaco tent.
I wasn't going very fast either.
Guys?
I just stood up, bam.
Yeah.
Mark Martin's closing in on the 21 car if we want to show. Okay. I'm just trying to help. Okay.
Buddy, she's messing with your flowers.
Yeah, water. There goes my flowers.
This thing's really getting ugly.
Yeah. The bottom flowers don't cross his hands. Just lay them right here.
Nobody would ever know for a week or two.
And then the smell would get them.
Yeah. Well,
yeah.
Like I say, a week or two.
Not tea, I'd die. Anything but tea.
Anything?
Oh. Did you call him, tell him to start racing? Would you please?
Now we might have a race for a second here.
We need a caution. Throw something.
Where's Jacques
and Pierre, the two French drivers, the Debris brothers.
The Debris brothers.
But yes. You know, if Ernie Irvin was leading this race, the last thing he'd want to see?
Caution. I've had it before.
Just 18 feet.
That's cool.
I love that. Welcome back to Loudoun, New Hampshire. Mike Joy with Buddy Baker and Ernie Irvin. Glenn Jarrett and Randy Pemberton on pit road, and Tony Glover yelling encouragement to his driver, Sterling Marlin, as you ride the Kodak Chevrolet.
That was funny what he said. He said it's only 18 feet to get by this car, make it happen.
what he was doing is telling him the spotter to tell Derek Cope's spotter, says, let us go, you know, we need to get by you. And man, it's only 18 feet.
Yeah, but it's also seventh place they're racing for.
Yeah.
You see, all the spotters stand in one area up on the roof to the right of our broadcast position. So, and since they all wear uniforms, it's not hard to tell who you need to go talk to if you either need a favor or need a little help or need to give somebody a little encouragement.
Like 17 or 19 feet.
Mike, I can guarantee you he wasn't asking the spotter to give him anything. They're racing for position.
Right.
Yeah.
And here's speaking Mark of racing Martin. For position, second place right here. Mark Martin, the pole sitter. He's up for a balance of nearly 100, balance bonus of nearly $100,000. That Unical bonus, $7,600 if the pole sitter wins the race, and if he doesn't, it rolls over, and they add $7,600 each race until somebody gets it. That's getting up into six figures right there.
Okay.
Seventh place.
Cope got out a little bit wide.
Oh, he only got 9 feet. Didn't get all 18.
No. Oh, he was like beside him and still didn't get him.
Here comes Sterling. Uh-huh. He's going to put a little heat on him, it looks like.
Yeah.
A little wiggle.
Oh, boy.
Glover will be talking to him here in a minute.
Can you find her spotter?
I told him.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Close, but no cigar.
Well, if you're driving Derek Cope's car, and your spotter tells you, the four car would like you to move over, please.
Yeah.
What is that, like, pass the gray coupon?
Yeah.
I mean, come on.
He just shook his head.
Yeah. He didn't say if he shook it side to side or up and down.
Just look where you are. We'll get him here in a minute.
I mean, it's racing for a position, right?
Right.
Yeah, well, I don't blame him for not moving over.
Right. Seventh place.
You know, Ernie, that might be just a little more chatter than I'd like in a car when I'm racing real close to somebody. I'd like the opportunity to think a little bit for myself, too.
Well, you know, Tony Glover's a different type of person, and he's funny. I mean, you know, they're from, you know, the team's up from Bristol and all that. They talk a little different up there.
Well, did he coach you like that when you drove that car?
You know, he didn't really coach me much. He was... Anytime he was talking to me, he was like, okay, calm down now, come on. Now he's got Sterling saying, okay, get it going. He would have to calm me down most of the time.
You don't particularly like a spotter to talk a lot?
No, I hardly ever have a spotter talk to me. Now I've listened to drivers. They always tell, the driver will always want to have them tell you if there's a car under you, high or whatever. I never really liked that. I like to just be able to judge for myself. It always was my type of deal.
Okay, we're watching for Dave Marcus's car just ahead of that battle. And the battle for second place remains a good one.
Mark Martin's putting a lot of pressure on Shepard, but Shepard's car is really getting through the corners quite well. I think Mark's turned the wick up just a little bit, though. He has an incentive. Pole position right now is going to collect a lot of money if he can win the race.
I think Mark needs to have his spotter tell Morgan's spotter that we only need 18 feet.
Yeah. Oh, we have a car in the wall. Jeff Bodine in turn four. Oh, he makes it across. The yellow flag is out.
Bodine makes it across to pit road. Second incident he's been involved in today.
We needed a caution, but we didn't want to see somebody wreck.
The X-Side Ford comes to a halt.
Man, they don't hardly have enough to work on this.
Where is the fuel cell at? It's like gone.
It's up under there somewhere. And back to the line.
Oh, look, teamwork happening.
Kenny Schrader, who, like Jeff Gordon, has a race car owned by Rick Hendrick, as that was Ernie Irvin who pointed that out.
Yeah.
Kenny gets a lap back from the race leader, so that will put Schrader back onto the lead lap.
Now, I wonder if Rick Hendricks gives Schrader or Jeff Gordon an extra bonus for letting one of his other cars have a lap back.
I wouldn't think. But if you're going to do a favor for somebody, it might as well be your teammate.
Yeah.
Because you're going to need a favor someday.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
That's the same guy signs all three checks. You know?
And there is the chance that Schrader beat Gordon back to the line.
Yeah, right.
I said, okay.
I think we'll see pit stops.
The only thing faster than that 24 today has been our camera people on top up here. They can go by him and pick up the next car in front of him.
Yep. Done a great job. And here is Jeff Gordon. Ray Evernham's crew get one more shot to put tires on this car and fuel. We have 30 laps to go. When they make this pit stop, it'll be an old-fashioned shootout.
I wonder if we'll see some two-tire stops right now.
Well, let's see. Randy?
I don't think so, but you never know. I'm going to check on Jeff Gordon's car right now. Looks like they're going two. Nobody loses their left side lugs. No chassis adjustment on the 24. The two car pits right in front of them. They want to go four tires. Glenn Jarrett, what goes on up them, then in the pit road?
Two tires up here for Mark Martin, guys. That's all they call for. That's all they ever planned on doing. It was two tires for Morgan Shepherd. He beats Mark Martin out of the pit, as does Terry Labonte. So two tires from here, two tires for Shepherd. They're risking, they're making that gamble. I think it's going to pay off for them.
Gordon is the first car out of the pits. Morgan Shepherd is second. Mark Martin is third. Terry Labonte is fourth. Ricky Rudd is fifth. Sterling Marlin is sixth. Rusty Wallace, seventh. Ted Musgrave, eighth.
Good hustle, gang.
Jeff Bodine going behind the wall.
Is Rusty one of the only guys that took on four? How do they do up there, Glenn?
No, Mark Martin and Morgan Shepherd both took on
two. They both took four.
Yeah, did not Sterling Marlin beat Cope out of the pits that time?
Yeah.
Did he get the position from him by that?
Yes, he did.
Okay.
How many laps will they have on their lefts then?
Everybody beat Derek Cope. When do they get four, Greg? Four tires for everybody. Here's how they're running after pit stops. We'll recap in a moment. Who got two tires? Who got four? Jeff Gordon, Morgan Shepherd, Mark Martin, Terry Labonte, Ricky Rudd, Sterling Marlin, Rusty Wallace, Ted Musgrave, Rick Mast, and Derek Cope are the top 10. There are now 22 cars on the lead lap to shoot it out. We'll double check that in a minute. No, that can't be right.
Well, boys, this thing's coming down to a
that thing right
less
there with
than
that
a 30 lap feature
did.
Here.
Yeah.
I mailed everybody that had sent us a get well card or something, about 60,000. We had a card company make a card, and the only way you can get this card is on our mailing list, and I sent them all out to all the people that mailed something to me.
60,000 people?
That's somewhat of 60,000.
$18,000 in postage?
Yep. Something like that.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's worth it, isn't it, Ernie? Nobody knows what that means to you when you're on your back.
Did Waltrip stay out?
Glenn Waltrip stayed out.
But he wasn't lap down, right?
We're checking.
Yeah, he'd probably be tail end of the lead.
After he made
that Darryl is tail. Darryl is tail end of the lead lap.
Yeah, I got you.
Okay.
But the only way you can get that card that I sent out is from there. So it's a collectible, too.
$18,000.
That's pretty neat, Ernie.
Stamps.
Two. Yeah,
$19,200 in stamps.
I don't know how much it was, but it's a lot.
Just 19. Yeah, right.
You don't know, a lot. Thank you. Don't even count.
We just started mailing them out. They just started coming out about probably 2 or 3 weeks ago.
I mentioned that, but you'd get a whole bunch more get well cards in a hurry.
Right. Yes.
So maybe we just ought to let it lay.
Yeah.
But that's a neat. Getting set for the restart. The cars that got only right side tires have 40 laps on their lefts. We'll see how this plays out over the next 27 laps. Darryl Waltrip's on the tail end of the lead lap, moves aside for leader Jeff Gordon. Morgan Shepherd in second. Mark Martin in third, Terry Labonte in fourth, fifth, Ricky Rudd, sixth, Sterling Marlin, seventh, Rusty Wallace. There are 16 cars on the lead lap, counting Darrell Waltrip. Not 20, as I said when we went to break. 16 cars on the lead lap to shoot it out.
Actually, Darrell Waltrip could have started on the outside lane.
Yes.
So he was being a big sportsman and moved to the inside lane.
And he also has a preferred line if he gets a jump right here.
And perhaps he will. We are under green, and Waltrip has a half a car length on Jeff Gordon. Three cars break away by about a length, but they have that high line into turn number one. Gordon, the 21 of Shepherd, and the 6 of Mark Martin. Back to racing with 26 laps to settle this. And riding with Mark Martin in third place.
Gordon and Shepherd broke free of everything there. They're out front. See Bobby Labonte in the interstate car there. Looks like he and...
Now he's a lap down, too.
He and Darrell fighting for 16th place. Jeff Gordon has sprung the latch, and the barn door is open, and he has taken off. Let's see if Morgan Shepherd can reel him in.
I think Morgan's going to have his hand full with the 6 car of Mark Martin, but I don't think he's going to run the 24 car of Jeff Gordon down. It looks like he might be the dominant car right now.
Right now?
Riding with Sterling Marlin as Dale Earnhardt goes by. Earnhardt is 2 laps down.
He's got 3 or 4 behind him now. 16 cars are.
Well, there's a guy, if he ever does get back up front again, I think can run with Jeff Gordon.
Wallace?
I think Rusty Wallace can run with him, but he's really got bad track position right at the moment.
Well, he put 4 guys.
Wallace has to pass 11 cars to get back to the front. Most of them are on the lead lap. Very side by side with Ted Musgrave.
What he has to be careful about, he might be quite a bit faster, but you have to play with the cars when you're passing them here. You just can't run up there and block them out. So he's got to be careful not to wipe himself out, too.
Gets under Nemechek, who's 1 lap down.
Actually, Morgan Shepherd is running right there with the 24 car.
Yep. Yes. Morgan's not losing anything to Jeff Gordon.
Sterling Marlin's off just a little bit down the
straightaway. He lost 18 feet.
Yep.
Yeah. That's Derek Cope and Bobby Allison's car, the main and tail. Number 12 just ahead of Sterling. And here comes Bill Elliott. John Andretti coming back toward the front. And Kenny Schrader, who is back on the lead lap. Number 25. Spencer there in the Campbell 23. Spencer is, wow, on the lead lap.
Yeah, he's on the lead lap, and he's running pretty good. He just hadn't had any track position today. You see him moving around there on Ted Musgrave trying to make that position.
Musgrave to the outside of Derek Cope. And now here comes Marlin. You're with them near 150 miles an hour as they get down that back straightaway and into turn 3. Morgan Shepherd, the gap constant to race leader Jeff Gordon, but closing in is Mark Martin.
And just behind him, you see the 5 car of Terry Labonte. He is running them all down. He's running quite well. This is on back in the pack there, but here comes Terry Labonte. You see him catching more Mark Martin going in the corner there.
Ooh, Rusty Wallace on the inside of Schrader.
Right there with Earnhardt.
And here is Labonte closing in on Martin. This may be a 4-car shootout 20 laps from now.
Well, the first place and the fourth place car right now are team cars, and they have basically the same engine. So it's just whether they made the right adjustments on this car. You know Terry Labonte knows how to win.
We saw Labonte earlier. A car would get up alongside him. He'd let him go and drop in line, like we said, picking and choosing his battles and when to make the run. This could be the time.
That part of the race is over. This is grab and go now.
Derek Cope underneath Joe Nemechek, who is not on the lead lap in the Burger King 87. 1 lap down.
This is Sterling Marlin we're riding with here, coming out of turn 2. going down the back straightaway. You see Nemechek's car all day long. The back end's been doing that, jumping out sideways.
Marlin's got a fender under. He's pulling alongside, makes the pass.
Way to hustle now, Hammer.
Did you say Hammer or Hamburger?
No, Hammer.
Oh.
Michael Waltrip in 14th position, racing with 23, Jimmy Spencer, 37, John Andretti, and the 1 of Rick Mast, Kenny Schrader in the 25. Those are all lead lap cars. 16 laps to go. Let's take one more break, and then we'll carry you through to the finish. You're watching Winston Cup Racing live on the Nashville Network.
Coming on right now. He's got the six car giving him a fit right now. You think there's any correlation between this track and Richmond as far as setup?
A little bit. More like Phoenix.
Well, he won Phoenix too, so yeah. He's pretty good anywhere though.
Yeah.
But the flat tracks like Pocono and all, he's always up front. And this reminds me a lot of some of the Pokemon tournaments, like one
three
turn coming out of three.
Ooh, he just about undone himself there.
Today's exclusive coverage of the Slick 5300 on TNN is brought to you by NAPA. We keep America running.
John Andretti off the pace in the Little Caesars Kmart. Kranefus Haas Ford had been running in the lead lap and in the top 10. But now we'll just have to roll this one out for 13 more laps.
Down to 11 laps, Mike, and I'm telling you, it's just... This car run very well all day, lead lap and everything, but you can see it's all over.
Tell you, Jeff Gordon has what, 10 or 11 laps to go, and doesn't look like anybody's going to be able to beat him.
Well, we asked the question at the top of the show, is this the year that youth finally overcomes experience? Maybe it is. Jeff Gordon, 23 years old, will celebrate his birthday at the Brickyard.
Mike, there's one thing you can't do. You can't celebrate 10 laps from the finish. You know you're the guy sitting beside of you at the Brickyard last year leading a race and had a flat right near the end of the race. The race is never over until the checkered flag falls.
You wanted to say till the fat lady sings, didn't
That's
you?
That's it. That's it. She's humming, but she's not
humming,
singing
yeah.
yet.
Get the pitch pipe. Ricky Craven has cut a tire down. He's coming around at reduced speed. A 1.4-second lead for Jeff Gordon. Morgan Shepherd is second. Pole sitter Mark Martin is third. Terry Labonte is fourth. Ricky Rudd is fifth. Sixth is Rusty Wallace. And seventh, good run for Derek Cope today.
You know, I talked to Jimmy Finning, the crew chief for that car, and he said that, the beginning of the year, they ran real well. And then it's all of a sudden, they lost everything. They really weren't running that good. And he said he went back and tried to, just make everything the same. And we're going to start over again. This is not an
Now behind them in eighth place is Ted Musgrave, and in ninth is the point leader, Sterling Marlin. If Marlin is unable to improve on his position, Jeff Gordon is going to get that 50 grand from Gatorade for being the halfway season point leader.
Can you believe that? Like he needs 50,000.
He's only 7 points behind Marlin going into this race.
And Marlin hasn't led.
And is ninth. So Gordon will get 175 for winning, plus, if he wins, 5 points for leading at least a lap, and he may wrap up the 5 points for leading the most laps.
Yeah, good.
So there's Musgrave, and here's Marlin. You're riding with Sterling.
So it could be a $50,000 bonus for sure.
See Kenny Frager there just behind Sterling Marlin. He's really flying through here right at the moment.
Keep again.
Now you see that back window going up and down. We had a call on our 800 number asking if that window was glass like in your passenger car.
No, it is plastic or Lexane.
That's why it's got a little give to it, but also it is shatterproof.
Right.
Where even safety glass is not completely shatterproof.
Right.
Five to go this time. Now, if Ken Schrader gets ahead of Sterling Marlin, that's 4 less points for Sterling.
4 less, yes.
From first through seventh place, the Winston Cup point breakdown drops 5 points per position. Then for a while, it drops 4 points per position. And then the rest of the field drops 3 points per position.
Yeah, it's like first through seventh or something.
I think so. And then seventh through 12th, it drops 4 points per position.
Right.
And then 3 points per spot from there on back.
Ted Musgrave's in the 16 car there. He just passed Jeremy Mayfield. Jeremy gets real loose right in front of Sterling Marlin. That's something you don't want to see before laps to go.
I'm sure. And Marlin underneath the 98 of Jeremy Mayfield there. The Western Auto mechanic of the race, Ray Evernham. Crew chief for Jeff Gordon, and the leader of the Rainbow Warriors on that DuPont refinishing Chevrolet.
And well earned.
Go back again mid-pack for this battle. From ninth place on back. Sterling Marlin with Kenny Schrader and Rick Mast trying to eke out a top 10 finish here.
Well, we haven't said much about Rick Mast, but he's right there in fifth or sixth?
Tenth.
Tenth.
Strong day today.
Well, if anything does happen to Jeff Gordon right here at the waning moments of this race, Morgan Shepherd will win his first race this year because he is really holding the same interval as he's had. And, you know, it can happen. Jeff Gordon got into the wall right there when he was qualifying.
Yes.
The black marks tell it all.
And for taking on those two tires and setting the stage for pit stops all day long, the number 24 crew under Ray Evernham also wins the Thompson RCA Pit Strategy Award for the day.
You see the Rainbow Warrior and the Tomahawk there. That's part of the
white flag. White flag for Jeff Gordon.
Last lap. Jeff Gordon trying to join Rusty Wallace and Ricky Rudd in the New Hampshire International Speedway record book and trying to pick up his fifth Winston Cup victory.
He's kind of eased up, and Morgan Shepherd's closing in a little bit on him. He pulled it down to about 15 or 20 car lengths, but it looks like Gordon's day.
I think he was just trying to make it in.
Off turn four into the checkered flag. Jeff Gordon wins the Slick 5300 at New Hampshire. Morgan Shepherd is second. Third goes to Mark Martin, the pole sitter. Terry Labonte is fourth. Ricky Rudd is fifth. We'll come back, go to Victory Lane, check on the Winston Cup point standing, give away that Gatorade 50 grand and more right after this.
Forty-five minutes.
You could be home by then.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we'll get them.
Is that the first time?
We're going to have 15 minutes worth of drivers. That's the problem.
Is that the first time?
No, I hear you. Oh, I hear you.
Oh, yeah.
Has anybody won back-to-back this year?
Greg, has anybody won back-to-back wins this year?
Before today.
I'll tell you in a second. No. Nobody has won two in a row.
Until today.
Jeff Gordon won three times in five races, but nobody's won back-to-back.
Took me a long time to win back-to-back.
All right, we're here.
Me too.
45.
That's okay. It's only 43 now.
Yeah. That's one hell of a crew chief back there. Where is he at?
He's on his way. He's hiding back here.
What do you need, buddy?
My helicopter started up.
Watch your camera lens there, Glenn, because if it hits Broderick's hair, it'll crash. I mean, it'll just smash.
Is that a line cub or is that a man? Oh, it's Broderick. Excuse me.
I'd like that. Come here, line.
Look, I will not do that.
That is a lion's head.
What is it?
Who's the big bearded guy in Winter's Circle?
Oh, Teresa's here. Look. See?
Randy from Woodward Chevrolet.
Teresa.
That ain't her.
No. I think that's Brooke.
Welcome back to New Hampshire International Speedway, where this record crowd is beginning to wonder how they're going to get to their cars and get on the road. Jeff Gordon celebrates in victory lane. Glenn Jarrett's there.
Well, Jeff takes a nice seat on the hood of the car, and to the best of my recollection, the only time that anybody else has had any fun this week was when you crash qualified, man. That thing was awesome today.
It was. I tell you, I got the best dang crew chief out there. He's amazing. You know, people talked to me this morning, and I mean, we didn't do any practice for this race. That just shows you how good he is, and or how lucky he can guess. I don't know, but you know, I was pretty confident in him going into the race. We had our troubles, and you know, this is a big test for this team to prove how strong we can be. We overcame an awful lot today. I got to thank them, this DuPont crew and DuPont Automotive Finishes, Valvoline, Coca-Cola, Xerox, Kellogg's. I mean, Goodyear tires had a great tire today, and of course that Chevy Monte Carlo was awesome. So man, I tell you, what a day.
Well, he got everybody named there. First time anybody this year has had back-to-back wins. You're on a phenomenal roll right now. You get the bonus for leading the points at halfway, but Ray Evernham stays inside your head. We were monitoring the radio there the last few laps, talking to you every lap, keeping you calm.
He was definitely keeping me calm. I almost had to come on there and say, hey, I know, but you know, that's just how good he is. I mean, he watches every corner, every lap, and he knows that if he doesn't talk to me, I'm gonna drive in deeper and deeper and deeper every lap. And every time he didn't talk to me, that's what I did. And I'd come on the radio and start complaining. He'd say, you know, start backing it off, slow down. As soon as I did that, bang, man, I just started taking off. And he made some great calls, some two tire stops and everything. And I guess the only other person I gotta thank is God. Man, he's definitely blessing me, that's for sure.
Were you guys talking at all about that $50,000 bonus from Gatorade?
I got to thank Gatorade, too, because they put up a lot of money, you know, to this sport. And we had a press conference the other day, and I really, you know, I wasn't even really in the conversation much. I was just sitting there because, you know, I was second in points. But this is just great. I got to say hey to Rick at home. I told you, buddy. I told you better be here. And he's not. But we're leading the points, got that $50,000. That's great.
All right, we're going to let him go celebrate. He wants another kiss from his wife, Brooke. I want one, too, but I'm not going to get it, so let's go to Randy.
Okay. Morgan Shepherd all smiles. Morgan, you gave it a heck of a run, but the kid's pretty tough.
Yeah, he was pretty strong. The 24 car was strong all day, but I tell you what, the Seco Thunderbird just kept gaining, and seems like through turn one I could gain on him a little bit, but I couldn't gain anywhere else, and I was just trying different lines, and we just couldn't come up with anything. I'm just I feel almost like we won the race. The way things have been going for us, so this is a big turnaround. Hey, I like to say we got Fran and Larry Britton here, and I'm glad they could be here to support us. They're our sponsors, Sidco, and we're real thankful to these folks.
Hey, congratulations on a good run, Morgan.
Thank you.
Glenn?
We're back in victory lane. Of course, this is the smiling face of Ray Evernham, Jeff Gordon's crew chief. And, you know, I might have to go along with Jeff. He may be the best in the business right now. We're going to present you with the Miller Genuine Draft Pit Crew Award. Congratulations, Ray. Another terrific job and made even that much better by having to repair a damaged race car. You guys were awesome.
Well, again, you know, we'd really like to thank TNN and Miller Genuine Draft for these awards. It means a lot to the guys, but I can only accept this on behalf of them. I'm really lucky to be part of these teams. These guys are making heroes out of me. We got a great sponsor, owner, and driver, and things are just clicking. The other day when we crashed, we said, you know, it's going to show us what we're made of, what we do on Sunday, not what we did today. So it shows what this, you know, group of guys is made out of. And, you know, I'm just so proud to be part of it. I can't tell you. And I want to say hi to Rick. He's home watching us. And I told you we were going to have a good day last night, boss. And we had a pretty good day.
Well, one more question now. You were a former driver. A lot of people may not know that. Ray used to drive modified cars. And he's been in a car. He knows what it's like. He's one of the coolest, calmest individuals I know, and I asked Jeff this question. You talk to him constantly to try to keep him calm down, keep him focused on what he's doing.
Yeah, you see, because I made all the mistakes, so I know what they are, and I don't want him to make them, so I just keep trying to tell him not to do what I did when I was driving.
Well, I tell you what, this man doesn't make very many mistakes today. Absolutely one of the best in the business. Congratulations to Ray Evernham and the entire DuPont Chevrolet team. Great job.
Fifth win of the season for Jeff Gordon, Ray Evernham, and that Hendrick Motorsports team. Who led the most laps got the 5 bonus points. We'll tell you when we come back to New Hampshire International Speedway after this.
Where did he finish? Where did Earnhardt finish?
Where did he finish? He finished 22nd.
Wow.
Should we show that again and point out who was getting into that plane? I couldn't really tell.
It's Earnhardt right there.
Yeah, he's just holding it. Pam, you just can't get that bothered. He's got pants on and he's holding a towel. Oh, yeah, I know. Things in the air before the door's shut.
He's
so if we show this, are we going to hammer him?
There's Teresa. There he is.
There's Taylor Nicole.
Shutting up.
Tune in tonight at 6 p.m. Eastern for Win, hosted by Rusty Wallace. This week, Rusty takes you to Saturday night small town tracks. They may be small, but the enthusiasm and the excitement's overwhelming. Tune in to Win for all the action at 6. Well, the fans filing out to hop in their cars, and drivers, owners, and other folks hopping into the helicopters to get a lift out of here and back to Concord and off for the trip home.
You know, Mike, every time I see Ray Evernham, I remember 1 year ago when they won the Coca-Cola 600 in Charlotte for their first win. Ray Evernham was catching more heat. A lot of people were writing stuff like he'll never make a real crew chief in the Winston Cup racing. What a difference a year makes. Now everybody celebrates the name.
Well, he was a modified driver and a good one on the tour, but I think a lot of this type of savvy came from working for Jay Signori as the shop foreman and later crew chief for the International Race of Champions. He got to work with some great drivers, some really top-notch mechanic and top-flight equipment, and certainly learned his trade, and it served him well. As far as leading the most laps, Sterling Marlin led 124 today. Jeff Gordon led 2 more than that and got the 5 bonus points.
I don't think it was Sterling Marlin.
Mark Martin. Yeah. Excuse me. Excuse me. The penmanship award does not go to Greg Field. Mark Martin, you're right. So Gordon got the 5-point bonus for leading the most laps today.
You know, Ray Evernham was talking to me the other day, and he said, man, how many trucks you got? And I said, we got 4 of them, I think. Mm-hmm. And he says, you know, Flemington was one of the places I used to run at all the time. He says, man, maybe I could drive your truck over there.
That's right.
And he goes, you know what? He says, if I drive it, I can fix it.
No, if he drives it, he has to fix it.
Ernie, I do believe you have a Ford truck, and I do not believe Evernham will be working with you.
Oh, details, details, details.
Minor stuff.
Oh.
Randy Pemberton's caught up with the fourth place finisher today.
Well, Terry Labonte's been granting some interviews. Terry, heck of a run. Wasn't a win. The kid's tough and the car's good.
Well, we had a great runner. Kellogg Chevrolet ran good all day, and we were a little bit better earlier in the race, and seemed like the track got some more rubber on it there, and I just could never really find the right line at the end of the race, and then we pitted and just got right side tires, and I wasn't quite as good. My car got a little bit tight in the center of the corner, but it's still a great run for us. I got to congratulate Jeff, my teammate, first and fourth. That's not bad.
How much of an inner rivalry has this become now with you guys? I know you're all good friends. You do a lot of testing, you exchange information, but he's starting to win some races on you guys.
I'll tell you what, he's awful tough, and they've got really a good deal going there, and they've been tough every week, and I'm happy for them. You know, if we can't win the championship, I hope they do.
Okay, congratulations on a good run. Guy that didn't have such a good day today, but came out okay, he's with Glenn Jarrett.
What? Not a bad day for Rusty Wallace. First of all, I'm amazed this guy just crawled out of a race car. It looks like he walked out of a department store. But good run. You just got caught back in traffic after that little cave-in on the fender there and never could get back to the front.
And that was about it. I worked from 20th up to the lead there at one time, and the car was just awesome all day long. It handled perfect. The motor ran great. Everything was just flawless. The pit stops were good. But I got an outside of Earnhardt there trying to get – I was leading the race. He tried to get underneath me. I slid up, and they started freight training me, and Ricky Rudd got in the side of me, and I tore the fender about off the left front. He probably didn't mean it, just contact. But we had to come in because the tire was rubbing on the fender. We cleared it out of the way, got going again. And then right there at the very end, I was running second. You know, I got right up to him, was going to get him. Probably wasn't going to be able to pass the 24, but we talked about putting two tires on. We decided to go for four, and that's what got us. It was the right call. But the tires were just a little bit mismatched, and it did work out, and we got a six out of it. But everybody did a great job. Robin did a super job today, and it was just a wonderful day for us, except we finished six.
Well, I talked to Robin a little bit this morning, Rusty, and you guys have got to be really heartened by the way you've been running on the racetrack. You had some problems for a while now, but the car has been competitive week after week after week lately.
Well, everybody keeps saying lately, what's wrong with Rusty? Because, you know, we haven't won four or five races like we normally do at this time, and we're six in the points. But I told him, I said, just stay tuned, because our second half's really going to be strong. We've had a lot of controversy. We're still having a problem with these cars with mismatch when it comes to equalness on the Monte Carlo and the Chevrolet, and we're still messing around with weird things like these sway bars and all that. But I think they're going to come to their senses and finally get that thing off. But great race today. I'd like to say to everybody, say hello to everybody who's down to the Bahamas watching and at home watching. It was a great day.
Congratulations again to Rusty Wallace on a good run. Now Randy standing by with Mark Martin.
Well, Mark, the Unical bonus still stands, unfortunately, but you had a pretty fair day.
Real good run for the Valvoline Cummins team. That was about all we could muster. We were real good the first half, but as the sealer wore off the racetrack, the setup kind of changed, and our car started getting a little bit tight, and there wasn't anything I could really do to it. We tried to do some things, and we just couldn't get it spectacular in the second half, so we'll settle for third today.
Okay, look ahead to next week.
Where's that, Pocono?
That's right.
We'll be looking good at Pocono. We always run good there. So we're looking forward to it. Our team is really performing at a top level. It's awesome.
Okay. Congratulations on another good run. Upstairs.
Thanks, Randy. Here's a look at the Winston Cup point standings. Jeff Gordon vaults into the point lead by 40 points over Sterling Marlin. Dale Earnhardt has dropped to third. Ted Musgrave, third is where Earnhardt started the day, but he has dropped to 92 points behind Gordon. Ted Musgrave holds on to fourth, but he is just 3 points ahead of Mark Martin. He was 31 points ahead of Mark coming into today. 6 through 10, Terry Labonte in sixth drops Rusty Wallace to seventh. Morgan Shepherd climbs from 10th to eighth. Michael Waltrip in a tie for eighth. And now 10th, Bobby Labonte. He was ninth this morning. Back in 11th would be Kenny Schrader. Ricky Rudd moves up to 12th, drops Bobby Hamilton to 13th. Derek Culp moves up to 14th, swaps spots with Bill Elliott. 16th will be Dale Jarrett. 17th, Steve Grissom. Darrell Waltrip moves up to 18th, displacing Jeff Bodine. And Brett Bodine edges John Andretti out of the top 20. That's at the halfway point in the season, 16 out of 31 races. And we'll be back to New Hampshire International Speedway after this.
Ugh.
Okay, Randy with Ted. Gotcha. I'm pretty nervous about this. Well, welcome back to the beautiful New Hampshire International Speedway. Thanks for staying with us as we continue our post-race interviews. And one of the guys I certainly wanted to talk to was Derek Cope. Had a great run today, and he always seems to run well here. He's really taken to this place. He won a Busch race here last year, and sometimes you get a handle on a place and you just won't let go.
Well, that's true. You know, I got to give credit to Jimmy and the guys. You know, we only got four laps of practice yesterday, and they made some choices in the car. You know, we had the straight arrow hill south Ford running really well and put it in a position to be up front.
Well, Derek, things started off real well for you earlier on this year. Then you hit kind of a slump, but it looks like now maybe you've turned the corner again. Looks like the team a little more competitive.
Well, again, like I said, Jimmy, they've worked real hard, you know, looking at the points in the cars and trying to find problems to alleviate them. And, you know, the cars are starting to drive a lot better. And, you know, we're trying a few new things, too, and they're starting to work. So maybe you'll start to see us up front here a little more.
I want to ask you a question. We were monitoring the radio conversation between Tony Glover and Sterling Marlin when you guys were having that great race for seventh place. And I know they were sending their spotter over to your spotter to ask you to give them a little break there. But that's kind of hard to do in the racetrack, isn't it?
Well, it's awful tough. You know, I was pushing a little bit, but I could get in the corner a little better than he could, you know. And I was trying to be smooth, and he was getting me off a little bit off of two. And I just thought if I could smooth out, I could put a little ground between him and then run my line again. He was forcing me in a line I didn't want. When I got a little breathing room, I could start to put a little, you know, a little ground between us. But it was a good battle. I had a lot of fun with him.
Well, it was fun for us to watch. Put you on the spot here a little bit. This your first top 10 finish since Darlington. Like I said, you had a little bit of a dry spell there. This is going to pump the team up because you were competitive. But how tough is it to have a big fast start like you did, a real competitive start, then have things dwindle away? Is it hard to keep the guys enthused?
Well, I think typically you would probably have that problem, but, you know, I've been very fortunate here, and that's why I'm going to be here for a while. These guys respect me, and I respect them, and they stayed within themselves, and I stay within myself. And we collectively worked harder at the shop, and I think you're starting to see it's proven some dividends for us.
Oh, absolutely, and I think Derek Cope has really learned a lot as a driver in the past year or so. He's won some races, but in the last year I've seen him become a really smart race driver. I think a real bright future for this young man. Wish this team the best. Let's go to Randy with Ted Musgrave.
That's right, Ted, Mr. Consistency Musgrave. Another solid run, an eighth today. Boy, you've had a lot of top 10 finishes.
Yeah, I think we just learned that. It was like that's 10 times that Family Channel car has been in top 10 in the last 16 races. So. You know, it just takes a little time. This is my second year here at Roush and the second year with the sponsor. And, you know, like I say, it just on and on and on. We get better and better. And we just didn't have the top-notch car. But track position meant so much today that if we could have had our car maybe in the top five on a restart, we could have held it. But, you know, working my way through, and the guys in the crew, you know, got me a lot of positions in the pits. It just was so hard to get up there, and we missed out. Another top 10 for the Family Channel car, so I'm happy.
What did you learn? What could you do to that car to make it run like the 24 car possibly did today?
Well, I think we'd have to change a lot of things. You know, we probably couldn't put this on the air anyway, and Ford would get mad at me and everybody else. But, you know, we just got to keep working hard, you know. They ran really good. They ran strong. They got a good program. But we just need, you know, if you look at the advancement my program here has made in 1 year, if I could just keep doing that and next year improve again, we'll be just as tough, I believe.
And I understand you're not done driving today. You're going to drive home from here.
Yeah, I was going to fly home with Mark in his jet, but you know me, I'm an avid collector of old cars. I just bought an old 59 Ford T-Bird, and I'm going to drive it home from here.
Unbelievable. Mike?
Well, if you see him going down the interstate, wave to Ted Musgrave in that Thunderbird convertible. Five straight top 10 finishes for Musgrave. Great run for him today. Here's the final. Jeff Gordon for Chevrolet in victory lane. Morgan Shepherd, best finish of the year. Mark Martin, the pole sitter. Terry Labonte comes home strong. Ricky Rudd, the defending champion, fifth. Rusty Wallace, Derek Cope, Ted Musgrave in eighth. Sterling Marlin, Ken Schrader wound up with a top 10. Rick Mast in 11th. Jimmy Spencer in 12th. 13th, Robert Presley. 14th, Michael Waltrip. 15th was Bobby Labonte, one lap down. 16th, Bobby Hamilton. 17th was Darrell Waltrip. In 18th, Bill Elliott. 19th, Joe Nemechek. And 20th was Bobby Hillen. 21st, Brett Bodine. 22nd, two laps down, Dale Earnhardt. 23rd, Elton Sawyer. 24th, Lake Speed. 25th was Jeff Burton. 26th, another lap down, Jeremy Mayfield. Then Hut Strickland, Steve Grissom, Dave Marcus, and Dale Jarrett after that first lap incident, dropping to 30th. Ricky Craven, Mike Wallace, John Andretti, Dick Trickle, Jeff Bodine behind the wall at the finish, as were Todd Bodine, Kyle Petty, Rich Bickle, Ward Burton, and Chuck Bown. Finally, Jimmy Hensley was the first car out of the race. We'll be back with more from New Hampshire International Speedway live on TNN right after this message. Okay.
Yay.
Yesterday's highlights. Okay.
Thank you. Is there any way we can find out whether Jimmy Hensley was hurt or not?
Yes, we can. We can send Diane or Dorothy. Can you go to the press box and see if Jimmy Hensley is okay? Just verify that Jimmy Hensley was not injured.
Because last we had the chance to see him,
should I say Glenn earlier? Okay. So Randy first. Promo three. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Okay.
Ding, ding, ding. Ding, 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 ding.
Steve Warner is the concert, is that right? Yes, thank you.
You better believe it.
Did you want to make that page before they start?
No.
Darn it. Okay. Join Rick Benjamin tonight for Race Day, live at 7:30 Eastern Time here on TNN Motorsports with all the news from the world of racing. Ninth victory of the season for Hendrick Engines. What an enviable record they have. But a young freshman driver who's had a lot of laps on this track had a good run here today. Glenn?
Well, he certainly did, Mike, and I'm pretty sure that this puts him in the lead for the Rookie of the Year standings right now. Good run for Robert Presley. Started out a little better than maybe what it finished, but still overall not a bad day.
Yeah, it was a good day. You know, we got to run up front there a little bit, and just our pit stops are off a little bit, you know. We've got to learn to do a little bit. You know, it's me coming in and me going out, and then while we're sitting there. But I really got to thank the Skull Bandit team. We had a good race car and
Jerry and all them boys at the motor room, they put one heck of a motor in. So just thank God for a good, safe race today.
Well, we talked about this earlier in the race at one time, Robert. I talked to your brother, Charlie, and you've got a lot of laps on this racetrack, a lot of experience here. That has to pay off.
It paid off, you know, in the long run of the, you know, we could go like 80 laps, and they would really beat us bad for like 40 laps, and then we would get to using some of the apron of the racetrack and diving, diamond the racetrack, and start catching back up to the leaders. But, you know, we need to get a little better fuel mileage where we don't have to pit for no tires or gas here.
Well, as I said, he's in a close battle with Ricky Craven for Rookie of the Year. Now, this is his son, Coleman. Coleman's the boss, and the boss says it's time for them to leave, so we're going to go down to Randy.
Well, Bobby Labonte talking to the coach, Joe Gibbs. We'll try and get a word with him. Bobby, we looked and saw early today you were running up front, track position. Wow, did that show something when you had to go to the back of the field?
Yeah, it really did. You know, I tell you, I didn't really think it was going to be that that hard to pass, but, you know, it was. And you know, we just had one little problem there, got us back, and then we got halfway up there and got spun with Bodine. Gee whiz, you know, and got back all the way back up 15th. So, hey, you know, it was... That was a great day for the Interstate Battery Chevrolet. We weren't really what we wanted to be, but we had a good top five car, maybe top 10 car, but we made the best out of something that we couldn't really control and salvage something out of it. So we'll go to the next race.
Track's tough to set up for here. Did you learn anything that you can come back with if they leave the pavement the way it is?
Yeah, you know, really, you know, I know it's just hard to pass on, and, you know, there wasn't a two-groove racetrack. It's about a groove. In the middle of the racetrack, you had to go up and dime in the corner. Most everybody did, so it was just hard to pass. But, you know, we got a pretty decent setup, but, you know, track position today meant more than maybe the next race.
Another flat track next week. Big one at Pocono. Can you win there?
Well, I don't know. We're definitely going to improve off of last time we were there.
Okay. Congratulations on another solid run anyway, even though it wasn't where you want.
That's the way it goes. Thanks a lot.
It's Bobby Labonte. We'll mention that Jimmy Hensley was treated and released from the infield care center here as we surmise, he just had the breath knocked out of him when he had that hard hit into the wall in turn number one. Hensley is okay. A lot of dignitaries here in the Granite State. And earlier, Glenn Jarrett caught up with one national figure who was here for the show.
Well, you know, one of the most recognizable faces here in the crowd today at New Hampshire, and a huge crowd it is that of Kansas Senator Robert Dole. You a big race fan, Senator?
Well, more or less. I watch a lot of it on television. I'm a big Richard Petty fan. He's from North Carolina. My wife's from North Carolina. He happened to be a good Republican. And so I've sort of followed it, not as closely as I probably should, but I remember 1976 was my first introduction to racing. It was in South Carolina, Darlington. I was there representing the Ford Dole ticket. Jimmy Carter is there representing himself. On that day, he won.
Well, now, I know that you have declared for the presidency, which the primaries will start in the not-too-distant future, but what about a running mate?
Well, what about Richard Petty? Think he's available? Or Dale Earnhardt? Some, you know, there are a lot of good people around, but I haven't made that decision yet. First, I've got to be the winner in the GOP sweepstakes for the nomination. And we don't have quite as many entries as you have here today, but we've got about 9 or 10, and the list is growing.
Wish you the best of luck, and have fun here today at the races. Big crowd here, the New England primary, one of the first, and he's not going to miss a chance to be in front of all these people.
I'll tell you, silly season has started in Winston Cup racing, and that other silly season has started as well here in the Granite State where it traditionally kicks off. The hat dance is going on in Victory Lane. Change the hat, take a picture. Ray Evernham, crew chief for Jeff Gordon. Well, we profiled Ray and want to take you with a little look inside what his thoughts are here midpoint in this season.
Despite the fact his team continues to linger close to the top in the point standings, Evernham isn't looking to race for a championship this year.
Our cars are not built for points racing. Our cars are built right now to win races. Our team's not ready. Our driver's not ready. That's just too much pressure. I mean, you wouldn't put a fighter with a couple of fights in the ring with a champion. You know, I don't want to get in the ring with Dale Earnhardt. You know, he's still the champion. We're going to make mistakes. You know, we're going to make mistakes like we did leading the Daytona 500, and you don't want that to crush a young team. You know, I just made a big mistake that cost us a bunch of points the other night at Charlotte. You know, we have to go through those things, learn how not to do them, and learn how to handle them as a group before you can become champions.
The ups and downs of racing can be very harsh. But Ray's son, Ray J, now in remission from leukemia, has helped to keep those pressures in perspective.
that is a major reality check. Every time I start thinking, oh boy, we should have put this, or, you know, gee, we lost that Martinsville race because we had a spring do this, or we did whatever, you know, you've got a reality check. When you come home and he's happy to see you and you think to yourself, this is what's important. You know, everything else you can live with as long as he's okay.
Helping his son Ray J has led Ray on a path to help others and keeps his competitive side in check with his charitable side.
I don't think of myself as a guardian angel, but I can tell you that I do go out of my way to help people whenever I can, because I know what it feels like to be dragging along the bottom and just have that hand reach out and grab you and somebody help you, because I've had my butt saved a couple times, and that's the truth. When all this is said and done, you know, this pool table will be gone, and these flags and these trophies and all that stuff is going to be gone. But, you know, I want to be able to leave the sport and have somebody say, hey, he was a good guy. That means more to me than anything.
Yeah. Pam. That.
Okay. Greg is gone. Okay. All right, Pam. No, Arthi. I need the rosters for those two races yesterday. I need numericals or something. Oh, okay, never mind. Thank you. Do we have any in-car that mod race within as part of that?
That might have been the best special I've ever watched just then.
It was nice. Good.
Huh?
Nice pitch.
And then he's wanting to let everybody think that they're not gearing up for the championship or nothing. But what he's doing is he's setting all the guys' mind.
Oh, yeah.
You know, he doesn't want to get them thinking about the championship.
Right.
Do you do that, Pam, that thing on Everham?
Pam, did you do that thing on Everham?
She's not. Never mind. Nothing.
And next week, we'll profile that other very nice guy, Michael Waldron. Because he needs some sympathy, too.
Yes, he does. He'd have got some if he'd have ducked in the right car.
Bob Bear standing down there in front of Steve Warner's tour bus.
Yeah,
making
right
it all
there.
Happen.
Stand by.
Welcome back to New Hampshire International Speedway. All those folks in line are for the helicopter shuttle out of here, and we would like to have interviewed defending Winston Cup champ Dale Earnhardt, but he was right at the head of the line and on the first chopper out after the cars rolled to a halt in the garage area, along with his wife and daughter. Meanwhile, Glenn and Randy are catching up on other stories in the garage area as Steve Warner gets set to play. Track owner Bob Bear knows that there's a bit of a delay getting out of here with the Route 106. It's three lanes south. And one thing they do here in New Hampshire for this track that I've never seen anywhere else, they have a four-lane interstate highway, Interstate 93, and they shut down all but one lane northbound so that they can have three lanes, two on one side of the median and one on the other going south to help get this traffic out of here as quickly as possible. I've never seen that anywhere else. They really stand behind this racetrack and try to help Bob Bear out because he has done an awful lot for tourism in this area. Glenn?
Well, Mike, I'm standing by with one of the brain trusts that's been behind the success of the Morgan McClure Racing Team that's put Sterling Marling so far up in the points. He's had a great season up to now. This is Tony Glover. Now, we listened to a lot of the radio conversation as Tony was encouraging Sterling there as he was having that great battle with Derek Cope. If I didn't know better, I would ask him if he were a cheerleader when he were younger, but I know that he started working on race cars when he was about 6 weeks old. So, but Tony, you do a lot of talking to Sterling. That really helps keep him calm, doesn't it?
Well, I just try to keep him focused, you know, on what we're trying to do in the race. You know, we're trying to get as far toward the front as we can, you know, gain as many points as we can. And, you know, let's face it, he's out there by himself with no one to talk to. And, you know, myself and Jerry, our spotter, are really the only communication he has or the only people he has to talk to. So, you know, we try to keep in contact with him and just make sure he don't do nothing wrong. And, you know, when he does something good, just boost him up.
Well, I have talked to you about this very thing before, and we have both agreed that it's part of the success of both the race team and the improvement in Sterling Marlin as a driver because of the communication between you two. You get along so well.
I tell you, we do. You know, he's a super neat guy. Me and him gets along great, and, you know, he's doing one heck of a job driving our race car this year.
Well, we had an ambulance come through here. We don't know what's going on right now. But, Tony, again, we appreciate you letting us listen in on the conversation. Congratulations on the first half you guys have had, and keep up the good work.
Well, we're going to do our best. You know, we're just going to take them one at a time and, you know, just try to keep working hard and, you know, see what happens at the end of the year.
Well, I got a feeling they're going to be there, Mike.
Glenn, I think you're right. Thanks. See, a lot of these folks have stayed for the Steve Wariner concert that Bob Bear is putting on for the folks. Let some of the traffic subside before everybody hauls on out of here. We had some great racing here yesterday. We were able to bring you much of it, the Auto Palace 150 for Busch Grand National North cars, but a long, long rain delay prevented us showing you the conclusion of that race or the modified 40-lap shootout. You will see it replayed on TNN a bit later on in this summer. Check your TV listings, but just for a little teaser, here's the last lap of the Busch Grand National North race. 47 is Kelly Moore, number 20. Trying to return home the conquering hero was Ricky Craven. Craven had just passed Moore one lap ago. The black car, that's Tommy Bowles, number 76, as you watch from Robbie Crouch's Don Ling Valvoline Pontiac. You see the track still a bit damp there, way down on the track apron as they run for the flag.
Mike, it was close every race yesterday. A few delays, but real good action all the way. Crowd's kind of gone because we had several rain showers, but they had a tremendous crowd before the rain started.
Craven won it. Kelly Moore, the point leader, second. Tommy Bowles, third. Great run for the unsponsored driver out of Ellington, Connecticut. Robbie Crouch, fourth. Keith Lamell, fifth. The rookie, Denny Doyle, great sixth-place run. Last year's winner, Martin Truex, was second. Mike Stefanik, the former modified champ. And, yes, that's Kenny Schrader there in ninth. And pole sitter Andy Santerre in tenth. A race we've rated all year to see, the modifieds of the Featherlight Tour. Boy, do they draft, do they run. Stephen Park in the lead. Tony Hirschman second, Jan Leedy the pole sitter third, and there on the inside is Tim Connolly.